Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Mark Griffin is joining us remotely today and we've had apologies from Annie Wells. And I would ask that all members and witnesses ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are we all agreed? The next item on our agenda for today is to take evidence on affordable housing. We'll be discussing this topic with two separate panels of witnesses today, and the first focusing on the rural context. We're joined for our first session by Donna Birrell, who's the Chief Executive Officer of Rural Stirling Housing Association, Rosalind Clark, who's the Director of Applecross Community Company, and they're both joining us online. And Mark Rogers, Executive Chief Officer of Housing and Property from Highland Council, and Mike Staples, Chief Executive of the South of Scotland Community Housing. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. It would be helpful if members could direct their questions to a specific witness where possible, although I will be happy to bring in others who wish to contribute. And if other witnesses do wish to comment, please indicate your desire to do so to me or the clerk, and I'll bring you in at an appropriate point. And I'd be grateful if Donna and Rosalind, you could indicate that you wish to come in by typing an R in the chat function in the blue jeans. And I now open the session to questions from members, and I'd like to begin by asking, probably for all four of you, really, what are the challenges to delivering affordable homes in your areas of operation? And how are you addressing these challenges? Do you have any good examples to share of that? And I think I'll begin with Donna, and then I'll just go around everybody. So, Donna.
Morning. Thanks for inviting me to give the evidence. Rural Stirling Housing Associations had a long track record of providing affordable homes and growing rural communities in areas that desperately need them. But unfortunately, when you talk about challenges, I think, I'm sorry to say that this track record is seriously in doubt. The biggest challenge that we're facing at the moment is increasing costs. Tender costs are coming back way in excess of our assumed budgeted figures, which renders projects unviable and unaffordable. We have typical costs per unit for financial appraisal assumptions of around about £143,000 a unit. That assumption is used right at the very outset of a project when we're developing it, because it's what we use to establish the grants that would come in and also to establish our private finance. Just to put the challenge in context, some sort of context, we've got two projects at the moment where total development costs per unit are in excess of 200,000. One sits approximately about £252,000 a unit and the other £254,000. So you can see that's considerably in excess of our standard assumption of about £140,000. So to put it bluntly, we were embarking on both of those projects today, carrying out our due diligence and our financial appraisals. We wouldn't be developing at all either of those two projects.
Thank you so much. That's such a stark example. And I wonder if you've got a sense of where you talked about the tender costs, right, being way in excess. So where's that coming from? Do you have a sense of that?
Well, there's labour shortages, material shortages, works costs are increasing. We also have, in addition to the standard cost per unit, we have additional quality measures which we have to introduce into new build schemes to meet various standards. For example, fire suppression systems to meet new building standards. And although there are allowances provided through the grant system to cover those additional costs, in reality, they don't actually bear any resemblance to what it actually caused. For example, we have a requirement for automatic fire suppression systems, and the assumption is about 3,000 per unit, but the actual costs are closer to 10. So the Scottish Government and the More Homes Division have been working closely with us and have been very supportive. But I really do have a concern, and I think most developing organisations, and particularly in rural areas, the cost, the benchmarks are not keeping a pace with what's actually happening on the ground. And in rural, to deliver much needed affordable housing in rural areas comes with its own challenges, challenges which we've seen over the last 30 years, but I don't think I've ever seen it quite as difficult as this. Rural areas, there's always a premium in terms of the contractors' overheads and prelims just because of our location, some of it being quite remote. We also don't get the same level of competition from contractors. It's normally we have a fewer field, and some of the big named contractors that operate in some more urban areas are not really interested in smaller developments of like 10, 12 units, which is typically what happens in rural areas.
Thank you very much for that, Donna. Mark, I wonder if the picture's similar in Highland Council. How's it going there for you?
Yeah, there are similar challenges. Tender costs are a particular challenge for us. As well as housing, I also have responsibility for the non-housing buildings. So we're seeing schools coming in up to 50% higher than the original price just within 6 months. So stuff that was priced at 40 million in September is now coming in at 60, 62. That's true across housing as well. So that's a big challenge. I think infrastructure is one of the big challenges for us. So if I give you two examples, I'm building two houses on the Isle of Rum at the present time. Building a house is building a house, but the challenge is the electricity supply in Rum is very, very fragile. We've only got a 40 amp supply to the school, for example, which is about a fifth of what you would have in a normal new house. So actually, in many respects, in a rural dimension, in addition to all the points you've heard from the first witness, actually infrastructure is a massive challenge, and it's very, very difficult within the constraints of the money we have available to be able to fund that. So we are seeing in some areas unit cost in excess of £250,000 to be able to build, as you've heard from the first witness, and on the islands that can easily exceed 300,000. So that's a particular challenge. We do also have a very limited contractor choice. That's absolutely true. One of the other challenges I would suggest that we have is actually a lack of development partners, and actually potentially one of the unintended consequences of the drive for greater energy efficiency in housing terms is, for example, a lot of my stock is on average 60 years old. I have a choice to make about the money I have available. Do I invest in retrofit to make sure that those properties are brought up to standard and maintain SHQS and EASH standards, or do I put that investment into much needed new housing, particularly social rent, because there's an absolute crisis of supply and demand in the Highlands. So those are some of the particular challenges. I don't want to dwell on some of the other points because they've been very well covered by the first witness. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. That's really that, you know, additional bit about the infrastructure and then also these difficult choices to make. It's very helpful. Mike, how's it going in the community-led housing sphere? What are the challenges?
Yeah, and we obviously come at this issue from a slightly different perspective as a community-led housing enabler. We're definitely facing similar challenges for the portfolio of projects that we're supporting with communities that have come to site since COVID. We're looking at an average of about 35% cost increase. Definitely challenges around the construction market, and a lot of the projects that we are supporting in rural areas are low scale but high impact for rural communities. So that, you know, smaller scale development, difficult to tender around issues of infrastructure when aligning to build cost through the Rural Housing Fund can be quite challenging. But I think a significant challenge for us in a housing environment that shifted massively in the south of Scotland post-COVID, particularly around issues like second home ownership, which, you know, have been a part of the narrative elsewhere in Scotland, maybe not in the south before. There are more communities, you know, we're engaged with far more communities now than we were at the outset of this. And the challenge for us as an enabler is actually being able to meet that demand through the resource that we have as an organisation. So that's a big issue for us and around how we are funded. And I made the immediate comment there that the rural housing enablers in Scotland were funded by the Scottish Government until March 2020 and are not at this point in time, although it is part of the Bute House agreement to revisit that position. But I think that for us that could make a big difference, because there are models that in the community-led approach that can help, particularly through driving partnership and driving powers within land reform that can assist with overall development cost.
Great, thank you very much for bringing in that perspective. Rosalind, so from Applecross Community Company, and I know all about your achievement, the housing project that you recently completed, and I see that you're going to embark on some more housing. So curious to hear what the challenges you have faced and what you're going to be facing with this new project.
Yes, thank you for inviting me this morning to talk to everyone. Yes, as you've mentioned, we've recently just completed three all-access houses for affordable rent for our community. And those are the first community-owned houses on the Applecross Peninsula. And it's the first houses for affordable rent in 18 years that have been built in Applecross. So we're really, really pleased that we've been able to achieve that. And we thank all the funders, the Rural Housing Fund and the SSE Sustainable Development Fund, for being able to help us achieve this. So there, as you're aware, there is a housing crisis in Applecross. There are a long list on the Highland Council's housing need register. I think there's 42 people on there, most of which who are looking for one bedroom houses. We have undertaken our own surveys, and similar numbers are showing up. And that lack of affordable housing is preventing young people from staying in our community, preventing people from coming back to our community, and also causing knock-on effects to our economy, where our local businesses don't have enough staff. So the challenges which we faced with our Antle Ban housing development, similar to the previous comments, we had a lack of competition at the tender stage. We only received one tender for our project, and the cost of that was higher than expected. And that's I've been advised that that is due to our rural location, just lack of contractors and lack of competition. So that was a challenge for us. We had to finance that additional cost to the company. And that puts financial pressure and risks to the company, where we are accessing loans, which we then have to carry with the company. And that puts pressure on the other aspects of our community company that provide those vital services for the community, whether that's our community broadband or our petrol station or the various services we provide. We also, the access to land is a key issue for us. It took us over 5 years to access this piece of land, which was only 0.25 of an acre. And we live in a 26,000 hectare peninsula, and that was the only piece of land that we were able to purchase through an asset transfer from the NHS Highland. And that took time and effort and so much grant funding through the Development Officer funding from HIE to be able to even get to that point. And it's that time and cost which is causing problems, where we're not able to address this crisis quick enough. And it's those it's our community that's suffering for that, whether moving away or not moving back. One of the other that we have been doing through a planning process to be able to, we did a community land use plan recently, and we worked with the local landowner to be able to identify future a piece of land for future development, which is really great. So we recently purchased 6 acres for that future development.
But that is one big concern for us, is the rise in prices for materials and construction, and how we'll be able to finance future housing developments.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Even more very useful full detail, and quite astounding, the issue of land there, to hear that. I've got a few more questions to go, and then I'll bring other members in. So who am I going to direct this to? I'll start with Mark, and then if you want to come in on this one, please indicate. So to what extent does the existing housing fund and planning system help to meet the specific challenges of developing affordable homes in rural areas? And how successfully has the Scottish Government helped to address those challenges?
Thanks. I think in purely numerical terms, if we look at outputs that have been delivered, then we can say that housing delivery has been fairly successful in affordable housing terms. So, for example, if I just take Inverness as an example, number of units delivered as against the local housing strategy target shows actually a slight overachievement of the original target as determined by the housing needs and demand assessment methodology. However, the challenge is, are we actually building the right homes to the right size, in the right place, at the right time, for the right people, of the right tenure? And I would have to say to you, I think the answer is absolutely not. So I can be looking at situations where homeless individuals can have a wait of up to 3 years in some circumstances in order to be able to successfully access permanent housing. So that is a massive challenge. To go back to the point my colleague from Applecross mentioned, there is a significant challenge in relation to one bed need in particular. But I think we need to be a bit more creative about how we deal with that. So I wouldn't necessarily suggest building one bed properties is the answer. The marginal cost of construction for that second bedroom is very small, whilst the Parliament continues to mitigate the bedroom tax issue, then it makes sense to build two-bed units and actually have them for one-bed need. People form and break up from relationships all of the time. There is a need for people to have somewhere where a child can come and visit, as well as somewhere where they can meet someone and start a relationship and be able to expand their family without having the cost of moving. So I would suggest that we do need to look at that. So I think, you know, we have had some success, but then when we look at some of the cost challenges across the Highlands, average earnings to be able to purchase a property range from 5.5 to nearly 9 times average earnings. So that's the big challenge that we've got. And if we are actually going to make a substantial difference to that, then what we are going to have to do is significantly increase the amount of social rented housing that we actually are able to deliver. So there is a huge supply-demand mismatch. If I think about that in areas such as Inverness, Lochaber, Midross, Badenoch and Strathspey, Skye and Lough Calsh, the total number of applicants for rented housing outweighs the number total of lets that are available by a factor of at least twice, and in some cases upwards of 4 times. So although we are successful in numerical terms, numbers of units output, actually, is it the right stuff in the right place? I don't think it is, particularly in relation to social rent. I think that's a big challenge. And should the challenge for us be, is this solely about numbers, 50,000 houses over a period of time, or is it actually about the right stuff in the right place? And, you know, critically, there's a dichotomy in some senses. There's a big housing pressure challenge in Inverness, for example. But then if you think about the massive difference of building a couple of houses in a remote location, such as Applecross, such as Rum, as I mentioned earlier on, how much of a difference does that make in terms of avoiding depopulation and allowing people to actually come back and stay in an area to create the opportunities for employment, for example, all of those things. And yet the cost, as you've heard from everyone that's commented this morning, is so significant that although the grant rates are more generous than they have been in the past, it's not touching the sides when you're talking about upwards of £250,000 per unit to deliver. So those are some of the key challenges. It's been good progress, but I think it needs to refocus going forward into addressing some of these points I've mentioned. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. That's really helpful. And obviously the point is that we're getting increased housing in Inverness because people are having to leave rural areas to some degree. And I really take your point that right houses in the right place is what we need to be looking at. Seems like we need to kind of drill down to another level of really kind of taking that into account and seeing what that should look like. Mike, you wanted to come in.
Thank you. I think I just wanted to make the point that the Rural Housing Fund is vital. It's really important that it's there and that there's a long-term commitment to continuity around that funding. So the renewal of the Rural Housing Fund is really welcome. I think at the moment there are always going to be challenges around deliverability at grant levels against development cost. I think we're looking at maybe, you know, 40% of development costs coming from the Rural Housing Fund. But again, I think we feel that the models that can come through community-led housing that are based on partnership with RSLs or using mechanisms such as the land fund or asset transfer to acquire land and buildings can really help that deliverability and increase some scale around that. Just to touch upon Mark's point, I think that issue of houses, obviously we welcome the commitment, 10% commitment to numbers in rural Scotland, but I think we know that consultation is taking place at the moment around the Remote Rural and Islands Action Plan that will come forward. I think it's very important that the targets around that are also outcomes based around the social benefits of delivering small developments in the right places, impacts on repopulation, local economy. In the south of Scotland, we know we need to repopulate to grow the economy. So all, demographic mix, all that stuff's as important as delivering numbers.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. I just want to say, Rosalind and Donna, you don't necessarily need to come in on this one, but I just want to make sure that you get your R in the chat when you do want to come in, because I know sometimes when you're doing a hybrid meeting, it can feel a bit difficult to come in on questions. So I'm going to ask two more questions. And the reason I'm asking these ones is because I do represent the Highlands and Islands. So I've got a lot of rural and island aspects, and then colleagues will come in. So I think this has been touched on a little bit maybe, but the Scottish Government is committed to developing a remote, rural and island housing plan. What do you think are the most important aspects to include in this plan? And maybe I will start with Mike.
Probably expected that I think I would want to highlight the significance of the enabler support relative to the community-led aspects of the action plan. And again, the point I was touching on there around outcomes being based upon social population and not simply numbers, but I think that the ability to build momentum and deliver more can be driven by community-led housing, forged by partnership, and that partnership being driven by the ability to work with RSLs and share risk, the ability to work with landowners, to work with the land reform agenda. But I think that the enabling organisations are certainly working at capacity and are facing financial challenges, and that support is vital to ensuring that communities have that comfort in the long term and support to go through complex project development and delivery.
Can I just, because I kind of want to unpack assumptions or something, go a little bit deeper there, so and you kind of started to touch on it in terms of community enablers support the, communities to do the delivery of their housing. But why is it the model of community-led housing so important? I think it's kind of been said, but it'd just be good to really articulate that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's important in terms of the capacity to understand and act upon very localised needs and demand. I think it's important in terms of the opportunities that it opens up for alternative types of delivery as a mechanism, as I've said before, for enacting partnership. As an example, around the work that we've done, the bulk of our projects that are about to complete or are nearing completion relate to existing vacant or derelict buildings, long-term vacant or derelict buildings. So I think the community-led approach has the capacity to tackle housing in a slightly different way, to look at delivering in places that are not being targeted by other providers. And that's not in any way to be sort of disparaging about other models, because I think what the partnership approach is at the core of this. But community empowerment is really critical, particularly post-COVID. We have a really supportive land reform agenda here that enables community ownership of land and buildings, and a funding environment around the Rural Housing Fund that can support development. So I think there's an enormous capacity to upscale that, but the support to the communities to undertake projects, the long-term support and expertise to do that and grow confidence is vital to upscaling delivery.
Thanks for that. You mentioned that community-led housing initiatives are able to provide different types of delivery, and you described using derelict vacant buildings and or building new buildings, but would also different types of delivery include different types of tenure?
Yes, absolutely. And it's another vital element of the mix around placemaking in particular, and the ability, looking, I know this committee has spent a lot of time on MPF4, but looking at localised place planning and communities taking a lead around that. And a lot of the projects that we work on, and we know that our colleagues in the Highlands work on, do relate to that idea of creating new places and building a model that's not just housing. And we certainly see the community-led housing agenda as being inherently about placemaking and supporting the development of other services alongside housing at the same time.
Thanks very much for that. Roslyn, I think you wanted to come in on this as well.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to agree with lots of the points raised there, and just almost just touch on the idea of supply and demand. So obviously the demand has been highlighted in Applecross, as it has been in many other rural areas in the Highlands. And it's even identified in our Highland Council local housing strategy, 17-22, and it's a long-term five-year priority. So all those things have been identified, but again, it's that land access, I think, which is holding that back. But talking about community-led development for housing, it is obviously we have the local understanding of the requirements and what we would need, but it's almost that capacity within our community company. We're a volunteer board with just one or two employees, and taking on such a huge project like that is a significant undertaking for a community company. And I suppose what I'd like to just highlight is the importance of that support from the Rural Housing Fund, from different grants, and also in terms of technical support. We're not experts in building housing developments. Planning support, again, support from those other partnerships, such as the Highland Council supporting us in our planning understandings, understanding that place-based development and how to tackle those and approach that. And also the grant funding, again, having that wraparound approach where it's able to support our communities and not put undue pressure on our small community companies.
Thanks, Roslyn. It's very good to hear that kind of right from the community's perspective, that issue that, yes, you are volunteer-led, and so that can be challenging to kind of hold that over time. Mark, you wanted to come in too.
Thanks, Chair. It's just a couple of brief observations. I think for me, and you've heard it actually just now, the challenge really is in land acquisition. The Highlands is a massive council area that, we often liken it to being broadly the size of Belgium in terms of its land footprint. It's an absolutely huge area, and yet land ownership is so heavily concentrated that one of the big challenges is actually being able to get available land. So you heard the Applecross example earlier on about, in a vast area such as that, the actual amount of available developable land is tiny, and that's one of the biggest challenges. So I think a number of us this morning have commented on the need for land ownership reform to be a key part of how we take this forward. It can't be looked at in isolation. It absolutely impacts on everything we're trying to do here. Just in terms of some of the other points about technical support in terms of planning and the technical support to delivery side, I think that's a point extremely well made. I don't know if local authorities were being entirely honest about this. Have we been as good about giving that direct support as we could have been? Perhaps not so much in the past. But I'm sort of reminded my background was in homelessness originally, and I'd never met a homeless person who really cared who built the house. Frankly, what they expect is us to work together across sectors to provide that support. Sometimes we will lead on direct provision, other times we need to be there facilitating and supporting people in being able to deliver that. And if a council is about anything, we have a huge range of technical experts and people who are able to provide that support. And I think it's for us to actually be getting better at engaging with people and understanding their support that they might need, and being much more open about providing that support and actually thinking about the wider social benefit that can be derived from that, rather than perhaps the approach in the past, which is, well, we're the technical experts, so if you just wouldn't mind leaving it to us, because that's not always had the most successful outcome. So I'm being quite candid about that, and I think that's worth a point worth making. And also, I think Mike made a good point there about acquiring existing properties on open markets and renovating empty properties. For example, we shouldn't just think about grant and other forms of funding as being available only for the purposes of building new. Actually, in many circumstances, acquiring existing and renovating is not only greener in terms of the energy cost of providing that unit, but it's also substantially quicker and can demonstrably provide just as much value for money. So we need to be a little bit wider in our thinking, I think. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you for that, Mark. I mean, just wonder also, I've been quite interested in the whole empty homes issue as well, and bring, you know, the work that's being done to bring those online. It seems like that's another opportunity in areas, and there seems to be quite high levels of vacant empty home property that we could be tapping into as well. Okay, I'm now going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everybody. I think we've been straight in to the deep end there. I was going to lead off on questions about costs, but you got there well before me. So could I maybe just tease out with you the possible ways through this? I mean, does the solution to this, does it lie in looking at the subsidy benchmarks? Do we have to increase them again? Is there anything being done to enhance the local supply chain network? Because you mentioned materials costs are going through the roof, and I don't know whether most of the materials are being brought into the rural community or indeed into Scotland. Is there work going on in there? Is there a role for private developers' contributions to be changed to try and assist? And I suppose, I think it was Donna that led off, is there any evidence yet that some of the projects are at risk of not going ahead or being delayed because of these escalating unit costs? So a number of questions in and around that area, please. So maybe Mike, would you start us off with some of your own thoughts, please?
I think at the moment it's going to continue to be a tricky issue until things begin to level off. I mean, I think that we can only reflect on this from a Southern Scottish perspective, and you know, I think in other parts of Scotland, some of these issues around supply chain and costs related to materials are probably more extreme than we face. I mean, I think that it's an issue of looking at this from every possible angle, and the increase in benchmarks is welcome and important, and any further work around that's important. But I think, as I've mentioned before, for us it's also about looking at what other angles can help. Delivery models, driving partnership, using existing buildings, using communities as an anchor to acquire land, or working with landowners. To give you a very specific example for us, Dumfries and Galloway Council has been a very strong supporter of looking at alternative mechanisms to deliver. I know this happens in other councils, but in Dumfries and Galloway, the income on council tax on second homes has been ring-fenced as a grant fund, very flexible grant fund that can be accessed by communities and RSLs. And for projects that we've been delivering, that very forward-thinking approach by the local authority is making the difference on the viability of some of the community-led projects. So I think things like that, I mean, we're discussing this very closely with South of Scotland Enterprise, and you know that they have an open ear and are very keen to try and engage around supply chain, the localised construction market, off-site construction, which I know you're going to hear more about today, and a lot of these things are going to take a bit of time. We're also trying to do work with South of Scotland Enterprise around skills development as well, which is, you know, an important issue. So I think for it's about a lot of things coming together in an innovative way to help projects move forward.
Thank you, Mike. Mark, I'd appreciate some views from you.
Thanks. I think the challenge is in the cost to develop units in many of our locations. So as well as just the general rural dimension, actually, we do find significant infrastructure abnormal costs, for example, in terms of land remediation, high decontamination costs, peat management in the Highlands, removal of rocks, et cetera, et cetera. There's a lot of land out there, even land that's not in our ownership, which is very, very difficult and challenging to be able to develop out. So when you start to think about how capital grant is thought of by the Scottish Government, then it is helpful to have that, but I don't know to what extent it accurately reflects some of the very high costs of developing in certain areas. And you heard from my colleague at the start this morning from Rural Stirling, who mentioned the challenges of scheme viability in relation to units coming in excess of £250,000. And that is a challenge for Highland Council, even though we can try to make the argument to justify it from a social value point of view. There are limits to how far we can actually stretch that funding in order to make sure that we are actually able to deliver the housing that we want to achieve. And I think the key point I'd ask you to consider is that without the discussion around additional subsidy, then additional investment effectively can only be achieved through increased borrowing funded through increased tenant rents. So that either has a direct impact in terms of the Social Security bill, or it has a direct impact on the incomes of tenants, most of whom are not particularly wealthy. And so it's a direct impact on those that are least able to afford it to a certain extent. So trying to balance out that investment need from capital grant, which I don't want to sound like I'm being ungrateful about it, but it is insufficient in some cases to be able to actually deliver the housing that we've talked about this morning that we all need. You heard from Mike about maximum use of council tax, so we continue to do that. We use the maximum allowable council tax from second and long-term empty homes to fund not only new council housing, but development loans, bridging finance, and to provide funding for land and infrastructure. So that's something that we are very keen on doing. And we look at a range of different ways in which we can try to increase the amount of social housing that is delivered through, for example, Section 75 and other contributions from developers who are building homes for outright sale. But the challenge is sometimes the kind of properties that we need to meet housing need are not the ones that the developers, frankly, want to build. And so there is a challenge in the sense of how much you can actually have reliance on direct provision through developers actually being a helpful contribution. It is, but not perhaps as much as some people might think.
Thank you, Mark.
Donna would like to come in.
Reference that was made to, is there a danger that perhaps some of these projects might not go ahead? We've got a current programme of 145 units across 8 different sites. 59 units are on site or have been completed, and 4 are likely to progress. But we've got 82 units that are in doubt. And to go back to the examples that I used in the opening remarks of the two projects where we've seen huge cost increases, one of the projects, our Balmaha project, tender costs are still too high, and we've gone through 2 separate value engineering exercises. The first savings exercise that we undertook, by the time we actually got through to the end of it, and that meant looking at different choices of materials, where that had an impact on planning, going back to planning, seeking approval for some of the changes. By the time we'd gone, I mean, that's a very time-consuming process. By the time we got through that exercise, tender prices had increased again. So it's extremely frustrating for us. And at the moment, that project was an exemplar project, and we've included different tenures as well within that small development. We've got housing for key workers who can't find permanent accommodation to live in close to where they work. We've got housing, 2 self-build plots, and some shared equity. So we are trying to deliver sustainable communities, but at the moment the pressures, the other witness mentioned pressures on rents. If the subsidies aren't increased, the only other option is to look at increasing the private finance that's going in, and that is pegged to rents and rent increases, which are already, you know, tenants are already being squeezed from all sides, rents, fuel costs, you know, food poverty, cost of living crisis. There's just so much pressure and so many, so much that we can put in terms of our rents and our own ability to raise finance.
Okay, and perhaps a final comment, convener from Roslyn, if you're still online there. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I agree with lots of the comments here today. We would welcome any sort of benchmark increase with the Rural Housing Fund. That would go a long way to support any future housing developments. For the project we just completed, Antoban, it was actually it was delivered on budget, which was excellent, and it was just prior to some of those increases coming in. So we were very lucky. But in terms of our future development, we are very nervous for the price of that we're expecting to get with that. And also just touching on the infrastructure costs. So we're in a grid constrained area, and we're expecting that the infrastructure costs to be able to facilitate a larger development there will be significant. And so that is an additional cost which perhaps is not reflected easily on the rural housing subsidy benchmarks. So any support to be able to enable that would be incredible.
Thank you very much. I think I'll allow other members in now. Okay. Convener, thanks very much for that.
So I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs with some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you, your panels. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to touch upon something Donna had said in her response, and it was with regards to affordable homes helping to sustain local communities. And I just wondered, in terms of, in a rural context certainly, what different models could be developed or have been developed to support key workers moving towards to work in different communities? And is there any sort of new models which you've gone and highlighted already or want to see developed by government and supported? Mark, I'll maybe bring you in to start.
Thanks. Key worker housing is a massive challenge. So I can give you two examples. We are in a situation where we are building two houses on run because that's the only way that the school can stay open. And if the school doesn't stay open because there's nowhere for the teachers to live, then the viability of that island as a place to live is seriously challenged. That is a challenge for us because of the very, very high unit cost, and the infrastructure is heavily constrained in the way that you heard mentioned just now. It's an absolute challenge. Elsewhere, Skye is a good example of that. So regular conversations with NHS Highland saying, you know what, the challenge is not even necessarily being able to attract staff to apply for and be appointed into jobs. It's the fact that they've got nowhere to live at all. Now, there are a range of reasons why that is the case. Housing that would have previously been available for let or that would have come onto the market for purchase is now no longer coming onto the market and is being used for a range of other short-term letting activities. And the challenge then is made much more difficult by the absolute lack of affordable land. So I think there are two dimensions to this. Part of this is about how do we finance this, and what different forms of models can we look at in terms of ways in which housing can be financed. And I do have some thoughts on that I'm happy to share. But I'm afraid at its most fundamental level, the challenge is land, actually, as much as anything else, particularly in Skye, and infrastructure. And then you can talk about what forms of different types of tenure you might want to see and how you're going to pay for it. But I'm afraid if you don't address the fact that there is, in some cases, absolutely no land at all in the first place to build on, you've got to start with that, and you've got to fix that problem before you can start to move on to get underneath the bonnet of the issues that you were raising.
Thanks. I think for you, for most people who've lived in a rural area, I grew up in rural Perthshire, and part of you know, looking back at my childhood without kind of having rose-tinted glasses at it, both our local nurse and local policeman had tied houses. Now, those were sold and have gone. And there's obviously been restructuring of how we deliver these services. But is other public services, like the NHS, for example, what sort of relationship do you have to develop different models with them so that these key workers can, especially in rural and remote communities, then to share that risk and potentially to get different funding models developed with the wider public service?
It's a good point. So I think there are two dimensions to that. The housing that we're building on RUM is going to be tied accommodation in with the employment. So there are examples of us doing directly that. If we set aside the land challenge for a minute, the NHS angle is an interesting one, as are the other public service public services. I think, you know, you can look at this. If I give the NHS example, you might want to make the argument that it would be useful for them to think about making a contribution in terms of capital for the provision of housing for specific types of staff, and indeed you could widen that out further. There's actually a viability gap quite often when you're talking about specific housing for people with particular health challenges, particularly those who are long-term sick and bed blocking. And if we were a bit more constructive about how we use the mix of the Scottish Government grant funding, local authority funding and NHS capital grant funding, you could actually do a lot to resolve bed blocking issues as well as provide accommodation for key workers. So that works in a number of different dimensions. I mean, there are a whole range of different ways in which you know, housing can be funded. You could think about the role of pension funds, for example, in contributing towards the capital cost and of providing these properties. Real estate investment trusts are another example of exactly that. There are a wide range of ways in which innovative private sector funding can be brought to the table here. And if you look at the example of both of those, pension funds and REITs are actually quite well used on a very large scale by housing associations south of the border in England in particular. So I wonder that perhaps there's a wider piece for us to consider across the sector as to how that might be much more widely introduced in a Scottish context. But again, come back to the point, you know, the challenge we've got now, and you were quite right to mention it, is the stock that was available in the past for tied accommodation for key workers has been sold off and has not been replaced as yet. We're making good steps and have made good steps in terms of numbers of output. I mentioned that in my earlier comments, but it's going to take many years before we have plugged the gaps that were created by, you know, effectively 40 years worth of right to buy, and that's the truth of the issue.
If Donna or Roslyn wanted to come in on that.
Donna or Roslyn, do you want to come in? You don't have to. You haven't indicated, so you can move on.
No. And my second question with regards to place, the importance of place has been really emphasised within Scottish Government's Housing 2040 policy document. And in terms of sustainable places, one of the key things has been around a rail link, really, to look towards developing new communities. What work's going on to really look towards where potential reopening, for example, of railway stations which are coming on stream, and then the potential to develop larger communities around those? Is that work which is taking place with yourselves as well, to look towards new community building that way? And also I wanted to ask with regards to new towns, whether or not that's something as well which you've been looking at in different areas to develop. Mike, well, I maybe bring you in on this and see if anyone wants to come in virtually, if they could put an R in the chat as well.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, from the community-led perspective, the principle of place and connectivity and alignment to principles such as 20-minute neighbourhoods are really significant. I mean, I think that, you know, speaking from the experience of Dumfries and Galloway, where the bulk of our projects have been, that it's a big challenge. It's a big challenge, and I think being able to live and work in rural Dumfries and Galloway and not be a car user is, in a lot of places, is very difficult to envisage. And from that perspective, I think when we're looking at creating communities and placemaking, what we're looking at acutely is trying to create opportunities to live and work in the same place to address some of these issues. We know in the Scottish Borders, the opening up of the rail link has had a big positive impact on the communities there. something that we would like really, you know, welcome in certain parts of Dumfries and Galloway.
And that infrastructure question, where do you think this isn't going right? You know, you mentioned the Borders Railway, and we see how those communities have expanded, and to some extent people are, you know, commuting into Edinburgh every day to work there. So maybe that's changed in the pandemic, but where is that not necessarily connecting up to be able to develop these communities? Is it the infrastructure first sort of approach, which we've been hearing a lot about, and a lot of that's to do with public services as well? How do we make that more, you know, streamlined to make sure that these are in place and communities are going to have what they need?
Yeah, I mean, that's a big question, I think. And, you know, working at the level of individual communities, I think it's perhaps difficult for them to influence some of these factors around connectivity and being joined up. And I think a lot of the work that we do is most oriented about trying to sustain the communities that are there. You had asked there about new towns and new settlements, for example. And there's obviously, you know, that's something that can be very driven by community-led housing, creating new sustainable communities. We're at the moment working on the support of a master plan on the edge of Dumfries, which is a much bigger housing development, is ostensibly rural but doesn't fall within the parameters of rurality for the Rural Housing Fund, for example. You know, that all of that has a big impact on the rural housing market and conditions around key workers, for example, which you had mentioned before. So, but I think how they extend these links to the more rural communities is a bigger question.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to move to questions from Marie McNair.
Thanks, Convener. Direct my question to Mark Hughes. Regarding net zero homes, can you tell us more about the approach been taken by Highland Council? What kind of investment has been made in this proposal, and how is progress?
So that's at the heart of everything that we do. We've got a challenge with our existing stock, for example, which is very, very difficult to bring up to standard. And so we use, wherever possible, passive house principles for our housing developments. We want to make sure, as best as we are able to do so, that actually the running costs of living in housing are reduced as much as possible. And so the easiest way to do that is to embody these design principles in the new stock that we build, and to make it as energy efficient as possible. So everything we've been doing in relation to our new build has been absolutely targeted towards that for those reasons. It's a key part of our design principles to make those properties as efficient as possible. The challenge sometimes is in encouraging tenants to use those properties in that way, particularly when it comes to things such as mechanical heat and ventilation systems. There is a perception sometimes that they can be quite expensive, or there's a perception that they are felt to be expensive because you can hear the motor running, but in actual fact the consumption overall, or the costs of running that home, are very much reduced. One of the particular challenges that we have in terms of energy efficiency is actually for our off-grid properties. So a large chunk of our stock is not and never will be on the gas grid, simple as that. And so the issue then is what alternatives are available in terms of ground or air source heating. And yes, those alternatives are available. But again, there are issues around perception about running costs of those properties, which are quite challenging. So part of it is about the physical building of the property itself, but part of it is around the perceptions of the cost of actually running that in terms of heating and ventilation, which can be challenging sometimes. But we're trying to address those in a coherent way and to bring tenants on board with us, because in the medium to longer term, the benefits are absolutely clear.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, I'm going to move on to questions from Paul McClellan.
Thank you, Convener. Mark, I want to pick up on the point that you mentioned about funding, and obviously through pension funds and through real estate investment trusts. I think there's an opportunity to try and expand that. Maybe asking the reasons why you think we're not as far advanced in Scotland as we are in the rest of the UK in that particular matter. And I suppose, kind of related to as well, and I'll open it up. You mentioned about particular in the Bout and Highland about the land being owned. Is there any opportunities in, you know, to look at how we could work with landowners in that regard to try and make that more attractive, for example, for housing? And what barriers do you see in that regard also?
I think, starting with the second point first, if that's okay. So I think the challenge for us as landowners have often got high expectations of land values, and they're not necessarily understanding fully the impact of constraints. So some of the things I mentioned earlier on about abnormal costs and the impact of developer contributions on land values. So many landowners that we find do actually not need to sell. So we do get challenges sometimes where zoned sites can lie dormant. And I talked earlier on about the general issues around land ownership across much of Scotland, and in particular in the Highland context. So those are well understood, but they do have a critical impact on housing delivery. So I'd said earlier on, I do think it's key, but land ownership reform is going to be essential in overcoming this. The four key things we need to build somewhere are effectively land assembly, planning permission, money and infrastructure. And actually one of the biggest breaks on that is actually any land at all and or land that is developable is the biggest challenge in relation to that. As to the second question, it's a little bit more difficult for me to directly comment on because, for example, the Pension Trust and Real Estate Investment Trust dimension is something that has been much more explored by housing associations in an English context. I think having worked both in Scotland and England for approximately half of my career, and half of it's been local government, half in housing associations, I think there is an inherent conservatism with a small c to the approach taken in Scotland. That's not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, in many respects, it's been a very good thing in avoiding some of the challenges that we've seen in the English context. But I do think that we do need to be a bit more attuned to being open to using alternative sources of funding. The challenge sometimes, and I've experienced this from talking to pension funds myself in the past, is that they will want a certain rate of return guaranteed over a period of time. And so that can become quite difficult when you're talking about being tied into contracts, for example, that expect an RPI or a CPI increase in their income over a period of time. And you need to be very careful that one of the unintended consequences of that isn't, amongst other things, that the rent increases that you need to then impose on tenants don't similarly have to go up at RPI or CPI plus, when actually most people's wages are not going up by RPI or CPI plus, and then you create an affordability or sustainability gap for the residents. So you are solving the infrastructural problem because you've taken the funding and you've built the housing, but in terms of the challenge of being able to afford to keep it from an organisational point of view and from the point of view of actually it being affordable in the medium to longer term for tenants, it's not without its challenges, but it should be explored further, is my view. Yeah,
thanks, Mark. I don't know if anybody else...
Anybody else want to come in on that question? The point? Anyone online? No? Okay.
Just one other thing. I think this has kind of been asked, and just if anybody else wants to add anything else, it's asking about RSLs and councils developing new homes more efficiently to reduce costs and ensure value for money. I think it's kind of been touched on. I don't know if anybody else wants to add anything on that particular point. If not, then that would be my questions, but just to confirm that.
Mark.
It's just a really quick point. One of the things that we are finding is that our partner RSLs in the Highlands are not developing either at all or at the scale they used to, because they are diverting their money, understandably, into making sure their stock is compliant with decent homes in East. So I think, again, if you're thinking of this from a strategic point of view, yes, we are talking about the need to grow the rate of housing delivery across a range of tenures, particularly the social rent sector, I would argue, but actually, counterintuitively, maybe perhaps, some of the things that we're trying to do to improve the existing stock are acting as a direct brake on the ability to use that money to grow the total number of units that are available in the system.
So these investment decisions are obviously impacting on RSLs and councils' ability, or I suppose desire to build new houses, as against you said getting up to...
Well, they will do. I mean, if I take my own stock base, it's 60 years old on average and I've got 14,000 units, so I have to get that balanced portfolio right between wanting to accelerate very definitely the rate of new build provision because I've got 10,000 people in the waiting list across the Highlands, but at the same time, if my stock becomes non-viable, the first thing I'll get is I'll get a telling off from the Scottish Housing Regulator, quite correctly, because my stock will not meet the standards. Yeah. And indeed, quite correctly, ethically, because that is a direct cost to the tenants that live in that stock, and it makes it more expensive for them to live in it. So these are all the sort of challenges we need to think about. As we said earlier on, when we were saying this is not just about numbers, it's also about land reform, at the same time, it's also about addressing the investment requirements and existing stock. You need to look at this as a whole system approach.
Yeah, yeah, thanks. And Donna, you want to come in on that as well?
Yeah, it was just really just to bear with what Mark just said. I mean, we've just carried out an energy audit of our stock to get some kind of handle and understanding of what the investment needs are going to be for it to meet the, our existing stock to meet each two. And we've just had a study confirming around about £10,000 a unit to meet those standards. So the investment that we have to make to achieve the regulatory requirements also has an impact on the level of investment that we have available for new build. And it is a very, very difficult balancing act, and one which is extremely challenging.
Thank you very much for that. Okay, we're going to move on to our final questions from Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Camina. I just wanted to ask members on the panel today about the sites that are currently in development, and just to ask what role modern methods of construction currently play in those sites. I'm thinking about how any modern construction methods are being employed to reduce unit costs or increase efficiency to reduce the cost of the eventual tenant, and just ask what they feel the Scottish Government's role might be in pushing that innovation out to, like I said, reduce costs for the developer and the tenant.
Is there anyone particular you'd like to start with, Mark?
I'm not sure, just if anyone has any experience in their current sites as to the construction methods.
Thanks.
They're using any innovation.
Okay. Anybody working with modern methods of construction yet? Mark?
So that's what we'll be doing on RUM. We will probably actually take an off-site prefabricated unit and ship it over, probably in two or three parts on a boat. Build a concrete pad, connect it up and deliver it, because for a range of reasons it makes more sense to do that than a traditional new build solution, breeze blocks and bricks for the sake of argument in that particular location. Prior to coming to the Highlands, I was in Dudley Council in the West Midlands for a period of time, and we partnered with the local housing association there, who actually had factory-built units. They had their own factory in the West Midlands that they used to construct those units. So I do have some experience of that being delivered. We did deliver some units of that nature in that authority. So we're perfectly open to it. It makes sense where it makes economic sense to do that, and particularly where you're looking to build out at a pace, then we should be open to all forms of construction. One size doesn't necessarily fit all. The only challenge I would say from experience of many years of working with a range of different housing archetypes is you've got to be sure that they're actually going to be fit for purpose in the medium to longer term. Council housing in particular is littered with lots of examples of stuff that was considered to be innovative at the time, but which sadly proved to be not particularly great in terms of its long-term costs or indeed viability, and some of it had to be statutorily declared unfit for purpose as a result. So we do have to be a little bit careful about that. But where we can innovate and we can use that to deliver units more quickly, or it's more appropriate for a particular geographical location, and I do think we should be open for that.
Thanks very much. And Donna wants to come in on this as well.
Yeah, I would just like to say it's something that we are looking at. We're actively looking at it for a scheme in one of our most northern line schemes in Tyndrum at the moment. But I think we are open to it, and certainly can see where it would produce efficiencies. But I think the problem, our schemes tend to be small unit numbers. I think there is a difficulty with scale. But I think if there was more support, Scottish Government support for that, to help make it work, then I think it's certainly something that we would be very interested in.
Thanks for that. I've got a supplementary on that for Mark. Do you think that it would help if the Scottish Government looked at actually placing factory in the kind of Highland area for scaling up with modern methods of construction?
I think we'd be very interested in having that conversation, absolutely.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, and I think, I mean, just also, Donna, on your comment, I'm aware that In Barra, there's a company that's set up in the Western Isles that is doing modern methods of construction, and they're going to be supplying the houses for six of the smart clackens in South Uist. So I think modern method of construction can be, you know, it's that building in a factory can be done on a small scale. There's quite a few companies I've become aware of across the Highlands that are delivering that kind of small scale, and it's really, really working for them. So hopefully, that, you know, more discussion around that would be great. And Roslyn, you want to come in as well.
Yes, thank you. Just to add that, again, we are very supportive of innovative types of construction for housing. And for our houses we just completed, it was just a traditional style that they undertook. And for our future houses, we hope to link this with our community-owned hydro station, which is beside it, and to be able to have almost like a district heating scheme to be able to provide renewable embedded energy to those homes. Which helps with the fuel poverty of our area, and also supports the net zero agenda. But again, it's the cost which is the question mark for us, and where we are able to access funding to be able to support that sort of initiative on that small scale.
Thanks for that, Rosalind. Mark, did you have any more questions you want to come back on?
Yep, Camilla, just to move on to affordability of rent, if that's okay. And I know it's been touched on already. I just wanted to ask whether investment programmes are essentially funded by rent rises, and just as we see the cost of units far outstripping the grant allocation from government, whether actually moving forward it's unsustainable really to fund these new builds through rent rises, and what impact that's having on affordability levels for your tenants. Sort of come to Mark first.
Well, it's a key challenge. So if I give you just an example of the breakdown of previous grant rates and current grant rates. So for the 2015 to 21 programme, say a unit cost of about 145,000, capitalised rent 70 grand of that, Scottish Government subsidy 60,000, and our own land bank subsidy 15,000. For the 2021 programme going forward the next 5 years, typical cost for a unit 175k, with some exceptions that I've already touched on previously, so that's not for the most rural communities. Capitalised rent element 70k, Scottish Government subsidy 90, so a very welcome increase in that, significant increase. It's very helpful. Again, land bank contribution to that. But the challenge is, and you identified yourself, Mark, that where you're starting to look at unit costs in excess of 250k, and that's true for Donna as well in the rural Stirling example that she gave at the start of her comments, then the challenge is, where is that gap met from? And the answers are, whether you're talking about Donna going for private finance or me raising finance through council borrowing secured against the assets to be able to deliver these units, ultimately that has to be paid for through rents. So you are going to find a challenge unless one or two things happens, either that grant element is further increased, or we look at how that gap funding element burden can be shared. But if the answers to that are it's not coming from anywhere else, then it comes from tenant rents. And I think the point you're making is a very valid one, that what does that mean in terms of affordability? And it does become challenged, even if you pull your rents across the totality of your stock and you have a large stock base to do it. Nonetheless, it will become challenging over time to be able to keep rents at the levels which deliver affordability in the proper sense to those who don't have a lot of money to start with. So that is the dichotomy in the most fundamental level. And I think, to give some credit to it, that has been recognised by the Scottish Government in the increases in the subsidy element. But the question is, whilst that works in a number of settings, and to what extent does that help us address those challenges of developing in particularly isolated rural communities, where that one or two houses has that big impact in terms of depopulation, in terms of repopulation, actually, to be positive about it, and in terms of employability. So that's the challenge, and I suspect, you know, how do we fund that gap is the conversation that all of us across the sector are going to have, and I think the Scottish Government is going to have to play a key role in revising, I think, in particular for the isolated rural and island communities. You know, you might want to make an argument to say that there needs to be some consideration given to greater capital grant allowances to address those challenges, particularly in the remote and rural areas, islands, remote west and north coast settlements, particularly in the border zone, Dumfries and Galloway as well. The argument is equally as applicable there. And I think, you know, it's for the Scottish Government to think about the social value element of that and how it wants to invest in that. But you also need to tie that in, as we said earlier on. It's not just about building the house. You know, building the house is building the house wherever you build the house. The challenge is actually getting contractors that will do it in the first place. And in many respects, it's the infrastructural challenges. Can you get a road into where that development is going to be? Actually, will the electricity and water and sewerage supply at a most basic level stand that development happening? And so it's investment around infrastructure as well as the unit cost of delivering the physical bricks and mortar that's really key.
Thank you. I don't know if Donna, you wanted to come in and talk about your balance between investment plans and how they're being funded and affordability of rents.
I'll just echo what Mark's already said. I mean, where the gap can't be plugged is from our rental income. I mean, our rent increase this year was 3.9%, and that's below. That's a below inflationary increase, which in our business plan is modelled on above inflationary increases. So the gap can't be funded from those which have, you know, our tenants have the least ability to shoulder that. The other a point I would like to make is that before we commit to a project, we have to have our private funding in place. We have already, with the schemes that I've talked about, the two that are in danger of maybe not going ahead, we have already looked at increasing our private finance element by about 5,000 a unit, just to see if we can help bridge that gap. But I don't think there's any scope to move that any further. The other thing is that before we go on site, we have to have a commitment that we've got the private funding in place. So if we... the cost schemes are taking so much longer now to get approved and then get the funding in place. If we commit to private finance too early and the scheme is further delayed, then we incur additional fees and non-utilisation costs because we're not drawing down the finance in accordance with the programme that the lender has agreed with us. So we can incur fees, which then that gets added already to you know, the pot where it's already been squeezed, and that's existing tenants paying for the finance difficulties of future developments. So it is a very, very difficult environment at the moment in all fronts.
Thanks, Convener.
Thanks. And Mike?
Obviously, again, a different perspective here from the community-led side of things, but I think just a, you know, an obvious point is that if communities are picking up the mantle of attempting to address issues of localised housing supply themselves, then the organisations that are supporting them want to minimise the risk. And for community-led development, I think that issue of access to finance and borrowing on projects is important, something that Rosalind will have experience of in Applecross, but I think it's important that the community organisations are borrowing commercially. They're normally borrowing from ethical lenders, but it's not always tremendously affordable. And I think the relationship with finance and borrowing for community-led housing is an area that the Scottish Government could provide some support around. I know there are some conversations with Scottish National Investment Bank around this issue. One point that hasn't come up in the conversation today is rural housing burdens as a mechanism around affordable sale. And again, that's an area in which support around the recognition of that product for delivery and for mortgages is an area that, that certainly we would welcome some support from the Scottish Government around.
Thanks very much. Thanks for bringing in that point about the rural housing burden. So that, I think, is our questions. I just want to... All right. Oh, so Rosalind, you wanted to come in as well. And I was just going to say, so if you want to respond to that question, but also I was just going to offer a little bit of time for anyone to bring in any critical points, like things like rural housing burdens that you really want to mention to us. I'll go around and see if anyone wants to come in. So if Rosalind, respond to the question, and if you've got anything else you need to add that you really want to make sure we hear, please do.
Yes, it was just to respond to say that accessing a private loan for the housing development we just completed was actually quite tricky, and we had to supplement that with additional funding from the community company, and we were right stretched at our limit to be able to achieve those three houses. And I suppose just to point out that we're not commercial developers, and so we cannot have the same risks and risk on commercial loaning, commercial loans that normally would happen. And so as we look to develop further houses, we're not sure how we would sit in terms of a future loan and how the company can carry that. So it's really important that any support that's available to those small organisations, either in advice or in financial support, would be really appreciated. Yeah.
Thanks very much for that. And Mike, do you have anything more you want to add? Just, you don't have to, but I just want to give you the opportunity.
Yeah, I think it's just from our perspective, it's useful to add that I had mentioned previously the significance of the Rural Housing Fund and that being in the long term. And I think it's important that there's a recognition that there's now a really significant pipeline around rural community-led housing in Scotland, and we're working, as you know, very closely with Communities Housing Trust, and between the organisations, you know, we have a really significant forward programme, as I've mentioned several times today, that the ability for the enablers to support that and bring that to fruition, and the resource within these organisations is really critical to that. But from the perspective of community confidence and pipeline, then we're actually in a really strong position to be able to upscale the sector.
Thanks very much. Mark, have you got anything you also want to make sure we hear?
Yeah, I think to me it's about increasing very much so the element of social rental stock that's actually available. So when I think about some of the housing markets that we have in the Highlands, there's very little supply of private rented property at all, and what there is quite expensive. Owner occupation is out of reach for many people when you're talking about averages at multiples of income of being anywhere between 5 and 8 times average earnings to be able to buy something. That's a challenge, even if you've got two people in employment, and the nature of employment in the Highlands, in particularly the rural areas, is often seasonal and relatively low earnings potential, which is difficult to get a mortgage around. I think, you know, I talked about earlier on about part of the challenges that provides, but also when you look at the challenges through the prism of housing need in particular, you know, we have some real challenge. So only 25% of those on our list that have a need of accessible housing are currently being successfully housed. Extreme overcrowding is only 2% of all applications, but only 6% of applicants with that cumulative need are actually becoming successful. So, you know, the challenge for me in particular is I have 10,000 people in need across a range of categories, and that's not going anywhere anytime quickly, and building our way out of that's going to be challenging. Just as a final point, I think the housing needs and demand assessment methodology at the present time does not help rural organisations at all. I won't go into the detail of that, but our argument would be that whilst that methodology works pretty well in a central Scotland context, it's not delivering the outcomes in terms of identifying what stock actually needs to be built and delivered across the Highlands. And so we need to have a much better link in with what our own waiting list assessments of requirements, particularly for those in need of affordable and social rented housing, is telling us, and perhaps not be so tightly bound by either the HND as it currently exists, or at least be prepared to have a discussion around whether or not there needs to be a different method of assessing that need and output requirement for the rural parts of Scotland.
Thank you very much for that insight. Actually, that's really useful. Donna, do you have anything that you want to make sure we hear? Or we heard it all?
Nothing further to add.
Okay, thank you very much. I mean, clearly, this has been a very, very useful conversation. And I think we've gone from the kind of high level kind of highlights of things like land being a key issue and the infrastructure piece. That's not just about building the housing. There's the aspect of placemaking as well, because I think that's what we're looking to in rural and islands, is that it can't just be about sticking up a whole lot of houses and that's it. So there's that aspect that you touched on around the needs for placemaking. And obviously there's kind of how do you fund those aspects too, right? If there's money for the housing, but not for the kind of shared common spaces, live work type settings and things like that. But and then also really fantastic to get that kind of drill mark from you, the drilling down of these figures and the reality of how do we actually fund housing when it starts to get over, you know, get up towards 250,000 for a unit, and then also the challenges on places like Rum. So I think this has been a very useful conversation. I think actually really grateful for the four of you with these very different perspectives, from Roslyn with your Applecross community and, you know, right there, the enabling aspects, and then both Donna and Mark yourselves with your perspectives on a slightly larger scale. So thank you so much for coming today. I was going to say coming in, but some of us are not zooming in, teamsing in, and very much appreciate that. So I now suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of the witnesses. Thank you. We're now joined by our second panel on affordable housing, and I welcome to the meeting Stephen Henderson, who's the Group Director of Finance, and Frank McCafferty, who is the Group Director of Assets and Repairs from the Wheatley Group, Pam Humphreys, who is Head of Planning and Regeneration of North Lanarkshire Council, Tom Norris, who is the Managing Director of Places for People Scotland, Colin Proctor, who is the Director of Construction, Industry and Delivery, and Neil Rutherford, who's the Senior Associate Director of Housing and Economic Investment at the Scottish Futures Trust, and Elaine Scott, who's the Head of Housing Strategy and Development from the City of Edinburgh Council. Both the Wheatley Group and the Scottish Futures Trust are represented by two witnesses with different areas of expertise, and in the interest of time, I'd be grateful if a single witness from each organisation could respond to any given question. And again, it would be helpful if members could direct their questions to a specific witness where possible, although I will be happy to bring in others who wish to contribute. And if other witnesses do wish to comment, please indicate your desire to do so to me or the clerk, and I'll bring you in at an appropriate moment. So I'm now going to ask the opening question, and actually will address it to all of you except from Futures Trust and the Wheatley Group, if just one of you can respond to that. And it's kind of more of an opening general question, so you'll have to divvy it up from across the room. So what are the challenges to delivering affordable homes in your area of operation, and how are you addressing these challenges? Do you have any good examples to share? And I will begin with Pam.
Thank you. Morning, everyone. So for us, at the moment, we've got a commitment to deliver 5,000 new homes by 2035. We're just about to complete our 1,000th new build home, and a big part of our programme is also purchasing ex-council houses and refurbishing them. So in terms of the current challenges, we've always had challenges in North Lanarkshire, as with others, in terms of our sites and our ground conditions. We particularly focus on developing brownfield sites, a number of the sites being within town centres or within small existing communities that were previously developed. So we've got challenges around ground conditions, infrastructure, Scottish Water, being able to connect, to get connections. So all of those challenges we've always had, and we've had to work through those in terms of make sure we've got good lead-in times, make sure we've got do the design and planning work in advance to make sure we've got as much preparation done before we get on site or we get the contractor appointed. Obviously, the current challenges, as I'm sure everybody will talk about, is the increases in terms of the cost increases and the impact of that in terms of our sort of future projections for the delivery of the programme. And as others have also commented on, balancing that against existing needs for stock. We've got an ageing stock as well. We've got over 36,000 homes that need various levels of investment, and we're committed obviously to making sure that they're built up to the best quality as well. So it's the challenges of funding, making sure that we continue to deliver the programme even in the current climate. So some of the rural authorities were talking about their current prices. Our tender prices aren't much below that. We're well over now £200,000 a unit, and that includes on some of our larger sites where we have been able to get over 100 units on site. So it's not just because some of the sites are quite small. In terms of, I suppose, how we're addressing that, we've been looking at different ways of different methods of procurement as well, making sure we use the frameworks, trying to make sure, as I say, we get economies of scale from looking at some of the larger sites, joining some of the sites together in town centres. So looking at all of those opportunities, it's probably at the moment not really impacting in terms of the cost. The costs are, I think, out with everybody's control in terms of the challenges. One of the, for us, as I mentioned earlier, the buyback programme is particularly important for us. It always has been, and is increasingly so, because it not only is good value for money, we've been able to acquire and refurbish units at under £100,000 a unit, quite significantly under in some cases. but also assists us in terms of getting full ownership of mixed tenure blocks. It then enables us to progress work in those blocks where we've not been able to do so before. So it ticks a number of boxes. It brings empty homes back into use. It also addresses sometimes where homes have been in ownership of private landlords and maybe not been particularly well managed. So for us, it's trying to get that balance between the new build, which helps address particular needs, and particularly if people have disabilities or need larger homes, but getting the balance right between new build, but also using the buyback scheme as well.
Thanks very much for that. Maybe somebody from the Wheatley Group?
Thank you. Yes, I'd echo much of what Pam just said there in terms of the challenges that we have. It's much the same as the first group of witnesses that you had as well. Across the board, from the identifying land at the very start of the process all the way through, there are now pressures all the way through the system in terms of how we deliver new homes. We have got a significant programme. We've built over 5,000 houses in the last 10 years. And to continue that delivery will be a challenge. We're working across the sector with partners, both in terms of local authority and partners within the construction industry as well. I think we've discussed that. You'll hear that a lot more in terms of costs. Echo what Pam's saying, and I'm sure other members will say the same sort of thing. We're experiencing costs now up to £200,000 per unit as well, and that's and not insignificant developments of 30 plus units, and that's for a number of reasons. And the other real challenge we're having just now is trying to tie down prices. So where we think we've got a fixed cost, I can give an example of a project that we had a tender received last July, and we've had two increases since then. We've still not managed to get that on site, a substantial project, but we're up over 13% of an increase from the original winning tender price, and we're still not over the line in that project yet. So the time taken to address some of the challenges as well is significant and can exacerbate those challenges, I think, from the previous witnesses, you'd heard that in terms of whilst you try to solve one problem, the time taken to do that, the prices have increased, and for various reasons. And we see all across various measures, BCIS, Office of National Statistics are talking about price increases in construction between 8% and 10% over the course of this year, and that will continue into next year. So those are the main challenges. We're doing some similar things, as Pam said. We're trying to make sure that we're discussing these issues with the contractors that we use, looking at other forms of procurement as well, to try and mitigate some of the price increases. But it's being sympathetic to contractors and the supply chain as well, because there are real pressures upon them. I've had experience recently of, for example, in steelwork, costs only been held by supply chain for 24 hours. So the difficulty in terms of timing in that as well is a significant pressure. I think we also experience some challenges around planning and resources within local authority partners in the planning system. There's much more emphasis on incorrectly and some of the issues around consultation with planners, but that does put pressure on the planning system itself to enable us to get projects through timelessly. So that's one of the other issues. Again, we're working with our local authority partners across the authorities that we are active in, to try and take some pressure off that by doing some consultation by ourselves, by looking at funding proposals as well through the planning system, and we'll continue to do that. So it's echoing much of what Pam has said and some of the other issues that were addressed this morning. I think the challenges are the same on the same themes, but slightly different in different areas.
Thanks very much for that, Frank. Elaine, how's it going in Edinburgh?
In Edinburgh, as committee will be aware, we do face significant challenges in terms of the housing market we operate in. So private sector rents in the city for a two-bed will be around £1,100 per calendar month. House prices can be six times average salary. We have a lower than average supply of social rented housing in comparison to the Scottish average. So that means the pressure on the social rented housing stock is absolutely enormous. Every home that becomes available for rent, for social rent, we will have around 150 households seeking to bid for that property. In terms of council homes that become available, in light of the significant homelessness pressures we have in the city, around 70% of our lets will go to homeless households, with the remainder then really largely going to people who have priority for accessible housing in order to maybe get out of hospital or to in order to remain at home. So that's the overall context in which we are seeking to deliver affordable housing within the city. We have a very ambitious programme to deliver 20,000 affordable homes in partnership with housing associations by 2027. And up until the pandemic, we were making very, very strong progress with that. And in 2019-20, we approved as a city 2,000 affordable homes for site start, a mix of homes through the programme, but also housing for mid-rent as well. So looking at other options as well as through the grant-funded programme. However, like as you've been hearing from witnesses today, we are facing very similar challenges in the city in terms of rising costs. So between 2021 and 2021 and 2022, we've seen an increase of 30,000 per unit in terms of the Affordable Housing Supply Programme unit cost, which is bringing it up to around 190,000 last year. But we are also anticipating pretty much every project coming in well above benchmark, you know, as we move forward, as the cost position remains challenging. I think the additional challenge for us, I would highlight, is as a council, we're developing sites which we have purchased onto the HRA from our general fund. But our RSL programme in the city is completely dependent on sites being brought forward by the private sector through the affordable housing planning policy. So a big concern for us, of course, is in the current context, if affordable developers and private developers are not able to bring, if we cannot reach a viable project through working with developers and private sites, there is a risk, of course, that they just simply won't be proceed or be significant or face significant delay. So big challenges. And just as others have said, we're also seeking in Edinburgh as a council to drive forward investment in our existing homes. We have 19,000 homes in the city in council rent. Around half of those are in mixed tenure blocks. So a big challenge for us is we need to work with owners in order to invest both in the private housing alongside council homes to deliver those improvements we need. And we also have around 15% of our stock in multi-storey blocks. So in terms of that challenge of bringing existing homes up to the energy efficiency standard for social housing and net zero carbon, significant challenges there, which we obviously require to fund through rental income. We're seeking to deliver a very large and ambitious affordable new supply programme, but also deliver a very ambitious investment in terms of our existing estate, all of which is much required in the city.
Thanks very much, Elaine. And maybe somebody from the Scottish Futures Trust. Neil, thanks.
So I would agree with a lot of the comments that have been made about the challenges. So rather than going over them, I mean, I guess adding to it, there are a couple of resource and capability that was touched on earlier on. The kind of role that we play, we want to help people deliver some of these sites, looking at strategic sites and other things. So some of that capacity, resource and people on the ground to help deliver is a big challenge in just making the system work. Sometimes there's complexity across the funding system. There are lots and lots of different pots of funding out there. And maybe using Granton as an example, we're working with Elaine and colleagues. Large-scale redevelopment, number of strands there, regeneration, net zero, housing, transport, all these kinds of things. How do we bring some of those funds together to give a holistic approach to that? And that's quite common across Scotland in terms of some of those larger sites. And as Elaine was talking about again, you know, that primary link to Section 75, access to land, bringing that forward, that's a big challenge. And I guess in terms of some of the questions, maybe some of the approaches we're looking at might help unlock some of that private sector land by using some different funding and financing tools. So very much keen to look at those kinds of things.
Thank you for that. Yes, I'm aware of the complexity of that funding landscape. I can't keep track of all these different pots of money, and it's not just in housing, it seems to be everywhere. Tom.
Thank you, and good morning, everybody. I think for places for people, I'd echo everything that's been said. On the cost point, I think that we're seeing increases, but not to the point that it's affecting our pipeline at the moment. So I think we're expecting to develop around 1,200 new homes over the next 3 years. So that's about £200 million of investment. I don't think that we're in a place that it's going to stop that programme at the moment. So I think there's positivity as well in terms of how things are being managed, you know, collaboration, working with other partners on how we deal with things. Our goal and what we're trying to do is all about placemaking communities, so not just, you know, numbers and hitting figures. So I think that the access to land question is really, really critical for us. It's becoming harder to get land, and it's becoming more expensive, and there's more competition. I'm sure some of us around the table will compete on land acquisition. So that for us as a RSL, I think, is really, really key as we move forward. On top of that, there's the investing in our current stock. So as much as we're developing more and we feel as though we've got capacity to do even more in Scotland, we're investing more in our current stock. We've got East 2, we've got Zero Net, we've got SHQS, and all of the requirements that require us to fund for our existing customers. And that's one of the nuances here, that we've got this stretch that's saying we need more social rent properties, and we also need homes which are more energy efficient and cheaper to live in. And there's this mix for us, and this stretch which is challenging for us to achieve. Having said that, we year on year we're upping investment in all of these areas. I think just a final point probably for me in terms of different financing. We're part of a larger group, Place for People Scotland, and we have PFP Capital, who are a fund manager and actually have a fund in Scotland and are bringing in institutional investors into mid-market rent in Edinburgh and Glasgow. So we do have some interesting examples of other ways of bringing investment into mid-market, and that's been successful. The fund is £182 million in terms of scale. So there are other ways we can do things. I think on that question of if we look, you know, our core is about, you know, affordable housing and social rent. We do have a challenge in terms of continuing to keep the development and the numbers flowing through. And I think that's probably pretty consistent for the sector, not just in Scotland, but our UK business is seeing that at the same time.
Great. Thank you very much for all those responses to the challenges and kind of moving into other areas there as well. I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey with questions.
Thanks very much again, Convener, and good morning, everybody. The cost issue, I was going to ask our local authority colleagues if they're experiencing the same kind of cost overruns that have been mentioned and you appear to be. Are those unit prices that you're talking about that are significantly higher than we had, are they coming about because of new material costs? Is it purely about sourcing new materials or materials to service the industry? And I'm glad Colin is here, so hopefully he could help us understand why these costs are going through the roof. And are those costing models based on existing methods of delivery? We've heard about off-site, we've heard about prefabrication, we've heard about sourcing alternative materials and so on and so forth. So are we changing the model of construction, or is it too early to tell whether that's going to be a success? Maybe we could start with Colin, please.
Yeah, I think there's a really interesting dynamic on the cost situation, because really there is already increased costs in the system because of all the new requirements that are being required. So that's already there. And obviously what we're experiencing in the market at the moment is quite high volatility, as you've said. And the challenge is we can't let the latter overcome the former, in that, you know, we still, I would suggest, still want to build these new requirements because they're good to do. And so there's a there's probably a short-term thing and a long-term thing there, and you've alluded to it in your question there in relation to what can we do now but think about for the longer term. And so new methods, and so we've heard this morning a lot of people willing to think about innovation and doing things in a different way. So different ways of delivering, different procurement methods, different ways of doing that. But also thinking, you know, are there other bigger changes that could happen in the system that could be more long term in terms of what's happening in the market? You're right. There are, and what's been said, there are labour issues and materials issues, and but also I think what we're observing is that housing has its own particular market issues, and there are some geographic issues around that as well. And we've heard already this morning around maybe lack of competition in the market, which has an impact as well. And when there's a higher demand and less supply chain available to deliver, you get increased costs. So there's interesting dynamics going on. So there are different sources of increased costs at the moment. And the common issues across construction at the moment are around, particularly around materials. A lot of materials are imported. So again, the longer term play could be do something more in Scotland and for components as well. And as already been said this morning, there are some, you know, labour issues as well. So there is an interesting cocktail just going on at the moment, and it is a challenge. But so I think that there is an issue there forming around prioritisation, and we've heard comments this morning around decisions being taken as to whether you stop a scheme or how do you prioritise. But if we're going to continue to move forward the programme, which is obviously the desire, and as Mark was saying this morning, the right house is in the right places. So doing the right thing is really important, and being able to prioritise. So the task is to try not to stop developing, think of ways to fund that in the short term and support that in the short term. But think of more longer-term things to bring into practice.
Mm-hmm. Just on the issue about the local supply chain, can we begin to solve this, or are we completely reliant on imported timber, for example, to help us with, you know, house frame construction? Can we solve it?
Well, on the work that Scottish Government and ourselves have been exploring around offsite construction and increasing that, we have been discussing a lot with Forest Scotland around the potential for being able to use local timber resource, and so there is that potential, and so that work is still underway to be able to do some further analysis on that. A lot of timber is imported at the moment, but certainly there is potential there to be able to be using local timber sources, which I don't, from what I hear, I don't think are being as used well as they could be. The other potential is in looking at other materials, but also other components. So manufacturing. So the net zero opportunity that's bringing along that is the potential for new components. So if you're looking at new window assemblies, door assemblies, other types of things, we should be looking to improve the manufacturing capability in Scotland to be able to do that. That's a more medium and longer term play, but certainly with a scale of a programme of 110,000, that's the opportunity that should be explored.
Colin, is anybody else coming in that area, or can I ask another?
Elaine.
Question? Elaine.
I suppose just to highlight a project that we do have underway as a demonstrator just now, which I think is quite significant in relation to what Colin was raising, which is the Edinburgh and South of Scotland Demonstrator Project. So it's a partnership of Offsite Scotland, which is offsite manufacturers within Scotland, and Scottish Futures Trust, Scottish Government, City of Edinburgh Council, and our regional partners. So what we're really seeking to do there is look at a whole new method of procurement linked into offsite construction to deliver net zero carbon homes. We're well into the pilot. We've got one project under construction just now, another site identified, and we're looking to build that pipeline up to really be able to do that and demonstrate that this can make a difference if we can do it at scale, and it'll give the industry the confidence then to invest as well in the transformation that's really needed and how we do things. Again, what we're seeing, though, is the costs for those initial pipeline projects are very high in comparison to, what we can really look to afford in the long term. So we need to look at ways that we can, support the pilot in that pipeline programme so that it can become sustainable and deliver in the medium term.
Thank you for that, Elaine. Could I move to another question, if I could, please, convener? Probably again to my local authority colleagues, and we heard from Mark earlier on in the first session, but I'm reminded of what Audit Scotland told us 2 years ago when they looked at the affordable housing issue, and they said it just wasn't clear to them how the national targets linked with local housing needs, and I think Mark referred to that in his contribution, so I was kind of hoping to get North Lanarkshire and Edinburgh's view of that, whether they share that view, or is it different in the urban setting? Do we think we have the numbers right, or does the model itself need to also change? Pam, maybe start with you.
Thanks, that's an easy one. In terms of the trying to get the balance between the overall target and the overall needs and the housing need and demand assessment, and then translate that into what can be very localised need. So, for example, I suppose in North Lanarkshire, quite a diverse area. If you look at it overall, if you were only looking at the sort of housing pressure and the supply and demand, you could say that in some areas there's not a huge gap between the supply and demand. We've got a good turnover of existing stock, but the issue is obviously, is it the right type of stock? Is it in the right areas? People don't necessarily want to move from one part of the authority to the complete opposite. There's also issues about accessibility and transport. So it's a much more complex picture, I suppose, than just looking at the figures themselves. But even on that basis, I think we would say that it's probably very light in terms of the assessment of the absolute need, and it doesn't reflect really the needs of the area, and you've got a whole lot of hidden housing needs as well, often within households. So I think it's a very complex picture, and I think it's pretty difficult, I would suggest, to get one methodology that can accurately assess and predict and put targets on this is the absolute figure, or this is the absolute amount of land that you need. But we do work, as certainly in the Central Belt, we obviously work collaboratively through the Glasgow and Clyde Valley, and so we work together around our housing need and demand assessment. So overall, I think it's as good as it can be, but I think it's a more complex picture than you can ever really do from the methodology that we use at the moment.
Okay, Pam. Elaine, is the model working for Edinburgh?
I think, as Pam says, the housing needs demand assessment tools, it is a complex area. We are looking at that on a regional basis, and we have just carried out our housing needs and demand assessment 3 for submission to government. I think overall it continues really to demonstrate very high levels of need for affordable housing, which I think is an important point. I think the other area, though, we've recognised that it's not as strong on as it needs to be, is really helping us to understand what the overall need is for accessible housing and on a cross tenure basis as well. So we recently commissioned some additional work in terms of an accessible housing study to assist with identifying what the need and demand is in terms of wheelchair accessible and other forms of accessible housing. And that is really even more difficult in some ways because of the range of different data sources that potentially need to be able to come together to be able to give that information. But what we have sought to do through that study is to hear real life experience as well in terms of people who are seeking to find accessible housing and how we can look at that to try and improve access to the accessible housing stock that we have.
Mm-hmm. And on the issue, I think it was also mentioned earlier, I think by Rosalind, I think, and maybe echoed by Mark, about Are we providing enough access to housing for example, young single professional people who are a single wage earner, obviously, and their ability to access these different housing models? Are we doing enough there, or do we need to do a little bit more to reach out? Neil?
I mean, I guess a lot of the work that we've been doing over the last few years around mid-market and reflecting that there are different needs within the housing system and how people are entering that and how they work and all these kinds of things. So a number of those approaches grew from National Housing Trust. Others on the panel as well have been in that space. But I guess it's the future aspirations of people about renting and owning and other things. So maybe shared ownership type models, shared equity type models, falling out of favour a little bit. Actually, do they have a role to play again and how they might come back? I guess a lot of the work that's been going on is almost additionality. So we have the grant programme, and then we have a series of other tools that can help us deliver and use different levers in terms of that, because grant can come in different forms, effectively. Come through land. We've had experience around financial transactions, so money that's lent effectively. So something like LAR Housing Trust, again, mid-market type approach is a good example of here's a different way that potentially we can help deliver. But I think there is a recognition that the system, you know, it is providing some address to that. Could it go further? Yes, it could. So it's really just understanding how some of these models fit for people, which brings you back to the Hondas and other things about demand and need and where that is. Different economic circumstances, you know, what kind of housing is needed where. So it's understanding that.
And we're gathering that sort of data, both Palm and Elaine, locally to pinpoint or understand groups of people that are not accessing the housing market in the way that they would wish to. Are we looking at that and feeding that into Scottish Government and others so that we can adapt these models in the future?
Quite difficult at times, because a lot of our analysis or in terms of housing need is based on the waiting list data, and which is not, you know, is clearly imperfect as well. And quite often, sort of, you know, the people that you're maybe referring to maybe would not think of, you know, council housing or social rented housing, or they would maybe be advised that, you know, that maybe their level of need would be such that for the areas that they're looking at, they would be maybe not high priority. So they maybe think, well, what's the point of putting my name on the list? Because we do try and give people good advice and housing options advice. So, you know, I suppose part of the impact of that is that people will maybe make a choice or decide, well, actually, you know, it's unlikely I'm going to get a particular house in the area I'm looking for, so you know, I'll need to try and meet my needs elsewhere. But yeah, we do use whatever data is available, particularly around the private, you know, rented. We kind of try and monitor that quite closely, what's happening in the private rented sector. You know, where's the, you know, you can see where the higher pressure is. We have obviously been looking at with SFT and others, you know, the mid-market rent models as a different kind of models we could bring in that would help meet that particular need. We haven't been able to make that work in our area, particularly because the private rent or the local housing allowance is quite low. So the gap is too large. Basically, we would need to somehow find a way of meeting that, and our priority is focused on our social rented programme. So I suppose a long answer to say we are trying to provide or to look at ways that we can identify that need and meet that need, but our main focus is on the most acute need and delivery of the social rented programme.
Colin?
I mean, it's not my area of expertise, but what I hear around is that, you know, some folks saying that, you know, there is an opportunity to have a look at the existing models and methodologies, and but also to be able to take that step back and look more strategically across Scotland. And so it's good to hear that, you know, so Edinburgh and partners are looking at a regional approach, and is that different from looking at a more local approach, and how you tie that in with economic planning as well and the relationship, and so. So I think that's it's a different dimension, but it's what I hear is worth looking at.
Thanks very much, everybody. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Now I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to develop further some of the questions we just had from my colleague Willie Coffey, with specific regards to Edinburgh. As an Edinburgh MSP, I probably put that interest out there as well, and the pressured areas we have across Scotland. Certainly Aberdeen used to have that, but Edinburgh is acutely overheated, many people keep telling me when I'm having these conversations. Now, how do you think that is being understood within government, especially given higher land costs? And is that becoming a key problem as well, of meeting the challenges in areas which are highly pressured as well? As I've mentioned, Edinburgh, maybe bring in Elaine to start.
Yes. Absolutely. I mean, the pressured housing market in Edinburgh is having an enormous impact. I think we hear anecdotally, I suppose, from businesses as well, that some of the challenges around being able to recruit and retain staff, and certainly health and social care workforce as well, all of it, the ability for people to access affordable housing is having a wider kind of economic impact as well. For us, I think our approach as a city has always been to work in partnership with RSLs, with developers, with other partners such as Scottish Futures Trust, really to explore every option, every innovation we can possibly do. Mid-market rent has had a big impact in the city. We were the largest participant in the National Housing Trust and delivered around 800 homes for mid-market rent through that initiative. And the learning from that allowed us then to proceed to set up our own Edinburgh Living, which is a limited liability partnership, which we're in partnership with SFT as a council in, to deliver mid-rent and market rent housing. So we've already got a few hundred homes in ownership, and a pipeline of homes we're delivering for Edinburgh Living through our own house building programme, and obviously keen to try and work with to bring private sector sites into development, potentially for Edinburgh Living and others to purchase homes. So it is very much for us, I think, with the scale of challenge we face, it is really looking across the board on a strategic basis at the whole range of kind of opportunities, mechanisms we can do to be able to support delivery of affordable housing, regeneration and place making across the city. Most of the land is in private ownership, and I think, as mentioned earlier, we are really keen to explore what else we can do, really, to get more private sector sites into development to meet affordable need in the city. So affordable home ownership, affordable rent, social rent being a huge priority for us in light of the homelessness pressures we have.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to come in on that, Tom?
Yeah, thanks, Miles. I think I'd echo what Elaine said, and I think in the Edinburgh context, MMR and the mid-market rent products have been successful. If you look at the Engine Yard, it's a good example of a collaboration of, you know, multiple organisations where you've got affordable rent, you've got over 55s, you've got mid-market rent, there's been development for sale there as well. And it's tenure blind when you go to the Engine Yard at the top of Leith Walk. And I think that we're finding we've got around 2,000 mid-market rent properties in Scotland, and they're ever so popular. So that point about, you know, the younger working people, it's absolutely key that we have that product available, I think. The other point is, if you take the average Edinburgh private rented sector rent, the MMR is about half. So it's quite a significant, reduction in rent, and it works as a model. And I think that's the thing for us in an environment where we've developed at the Engine Yard, which is in the city with, you know, it's brownfield, it's an old tram, depot, and with all of the challenges that you get there, it's a model that's worked very well. So I think we're very keen to see that tenure blind approach to development. Where you've got that mix of everything that caters for lots of people. And somewhere like Edinburgh, where, you know, you've got those higher rents, is a good example. I recognise in other areas, you know, the model may not stack up. But we've got, experience with that in both Edinburgh and in Glasgow as well, through the fund I talked about earlier.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. One of the things which I think all committee members are being, made aware of is supply of land issues. I think one of the we've heard earlier about that challenge in a rural context, but in an urban one, very much I'm concerned how, you know, some of the only brownfield site developments which we're seeing within local plans, which aren't necessarily going to come on stream. And I just wondered, with regards to the National Planning Framework, where you felt that's not necessarily in the right place at the minute to meet this demand around supply of land, and where, you know, planning departments are also looking at that, and maybe in terms of the financial question, where we're hearing that need to have that supply of land coming forward isn't necessarily there at the minute. Anyone want to?
Yes, I mean, I think in terms of land supply, there's probably two parts to it. It's kind of overall supply of land. But for us, I think the challenge as affordable developers is really getting control of that land. And, you know, for affordable developers to be able to go out and purchase land, we simply can't compete with volume builders and others to do so. And so we are really reliant on, as a council, as I said, we've been purchasing land from our general fund onto the HRA and then seeking to take forward regeneration and build affordable housing as part of that. And that's a land cost for the HRA to bear. In terms of the RSL programme, it's really seeking to secure the affordable housing policy 25% development as part of any development. But it is dependent on private developers bringing forward the sites for planning consent. So we're tied into their timeframes around when they want to sell and market homes. Yes, I think land, getting sufficient control over land to drive forward the affordable housing programmes at the scale and pace that we want to deliver at is a significant challenge.
Anyone else?
Pam.
Yeah, I'd just add to that in terms of our area. As I think I mentioned, I mean, I think it is important that we do look at, and I'm assuming your kind of question was wider than just the sort of social and affordable housing, but in terms of overall allocation of land for housing, I think it is important. We've still got large areas of previous industrial land that's zoned for housing that meets the requirements of NPF4 in terms of 20-minute neighbourhoods. It's well located, quite often close to public services and to public transport. So, you know, I think it is important that there's a focus on how do we develop that land, whether that's a mix of private and affordable or just for private. But the obviously major challenges around the ground conditions, all the issues we've talked about before, the infrastructure, and the connections. But I think in terms of the benefits, I think that there should be more emphasis put on how do we make these sites work, because before we start necessarily opening up more greenfield sites which don't have the benefits in terms of location and accessibility. So for us, it's definitely about trying to focus on how we can remediate and bring back into use some of our brownfield sites. But we've got major challenges, as you can imagine.
Can I just come in there in terms of the pressures, though, of decontamination and additional costs and things like that? Where is that unlikely to happen, and developers will therefore not bring forward these sorts of schemes? Do you know, that regularly told that brownfield sites are sometimes more expensive to then, come on online? So just wondered where that was being factored in, given all the cost pressures we're hearing.
Well, exactly. So that's why a lot of these sites, even prior to the kind of current challenges around cost pressures, these sites have not been been brought forward unless we're able to bring public this public subsidy to do. It's not so much contamination. A lot of the contamination has been addressed, so they're safe from that point of view. But environmental standards, quite rightly, improve all the time, and there's ground condition issues as well. So there's a range of challenges. But I think, putting the infrastructure in, putting more investment into, bringing the sites back into use. But bearing in mind that most of these sites, if not all of these sites, are not in public ownership, they're in private ownership. There can also be unrealistic expectations about land value in terms of what the landowners expect to get. So I think it's about working in partnership to see what can the public sector bring, if anything, and how can we work together to make these sites work, because as I say, that's where we've got the land, so why would we start to open up other greenfield sites if we can develop those sites first?
Okay. Thanks, Neil. Did you want to come in on
that? I was just going to make a very similar point to Pam. It's almost that place-based approach to some of this land in terms of, by dealing with it, I'm dealing with a whole load of other issues and potentially giving them good outcomes. So it was very similar to what Pam was going to say.
I'll maybe just add what's been very helpful for us. If I take the example of Glasgow City, is as a larger builder of social and affordable housing, having a long-term partnership agreement with that local authority, particularly where there's no Section 75 planning regime for affordable housing there, which has given us certainty of land supply and sites coming forward over a multi-year period. And to your point about the finance side of it, that allows us then to go out and raise private finance at scale, knowing we're going to have the throughput of sites and we can look to do larger scale arrangements with contractors and so on. So that closeness of working with local authority partners is absolutely key for us as an RSL.
Thank you. And do you think there's improvements, just finally, in terms of delivery agencies then? You know, obviously local authorities are playing that role, but in other parts of the country, especially around regeneration projects, we've seen different types of delivery agencies. And is that something you think could help drive this, so that, especially bringing additional private investment in, pension funds have been raised a couple of times, where that could be really sort of turbocharged to get this moving forward?
Mm-hmm. From our experience, the arrangements working with local authority partners have been very effective, actually, in recent years. And continuing to support them in their role as strategic housing authorities. Granted, there are circumstances where doing things on a regional basis are important in that wider strategic planning framework. I wouldn't see a strong argument at this time for adding another agency or body to the landscape around regeneration. We've had iterations of that in the past, Community Scotland and so on. Homes England performs a slightly different function down south, where it's funding elements and land elements. We're smaller and can, you know, work closer, I would say, as delivery bodies with local authorities. So I wouldn't see a strong rationale at this time for a regeneration agency nationally.
Thanks. Anyone else? No. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm going to now bring in Marie McNair.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for your time this morning. I'd like to go back to a previous point regarding net zero homes. We've heard, obviously, from Edinburgh Council in regards to the Edinburgh Home Demonstrator Partnership. I'd like to hear about how other authorities are approaching this, and I'd like to go to Pam Humphreys now. Can you tell us more about the approach that will be taken by North Lanarkshire Council? What kind of investments have been made in this proposal, and how is the progress going?
Yeah. So our standard specification in terms of the homes has increased over the years in terms of improving on the energy efficiency and improving. As standard, we're bringing the homes up to the sort of, sustainability silver aspect 1 and 2 standard, and we then start to increase, look at additional PV panels, for example, to go above that standard. More recently, and clearly we won't be able to fit gas boilers in the future, so it's a necessity, we start to look at alternative net zero heating sources. So we've got a number of pilot houses on site at the moment that are, they're not, it's not passive house, but it is net zero that our contractor CCG are building, and we want to sort of in effect assess the impact of those. So that's air source heat pumps, increased PV again, but also battery storage, which is quite expensive. I think the total extra cost for these units is about £20,000. So we really want to be able to assess the different component parts of that before, I suppose, we make larger scale decisions, and certainly the battery storage is probably the kind of more expensive element of that. So it's again trying to look at what is the most efficient way to deliver the net zero, and also echoing a point somebody made earlier around the you know, make sure tenants know how to get the best use of the homes as well, because there's so much going on. I think sometimes when tenants move into a new home and being able to understand how to operate some of these, the new technology effectively, doesn't always happen, and we've got then issues sometimes with condensation. So there's lots of, I think, other challenges around that as well. But that's you know, some of the areas that we're looking at the moment in terms of net zero.
Thank you. The suggestion by the UK government, they're thinking of introducing the right to buy to housing association homes, to tenants that are renting them. And I think Shelter have quite correctly condemned this. If this policy was ever reintroduced in Scotland, what impact would that have on the ability to meet the needs of affordable homes? And I'll just pop that out to everyone. Anyone could answer that? Or want to make a comment on it?
In terms of ability to take forward net zero carbon, one of the things that we're doing in Edinburgh, and I know other RSLs and local authorities are doing, is seeking to consolidate our ownership within blocks. And that is when homes become available in the market, purchasing those homes in order to do that has become really, really important. And we need, in the context of net zero carbon, really to find ways to support owners and social landlords within common blocks to be able to jointly bring the homes up to the net zero carbon standard. We're finding, because most of our half of our stock is in mixed tenure blocks, we're finding that for owners, the bills of just bringing homes up to the appropriate fabric standard, you know, is costly already, but net zero carbon will bring additional costs to that. So ways of jointly supporting owners and landlords to bring homes up. In terms of extensions of right to buy, I think in terms of the very big challenges we're facing to be able to house homeless people in temporary accommodation and others in priority need, that would further exacerbate an already very challenging position.
Anybody else wants to share a view on that one?
I mean, I think as you'd expect, I would say we would certainly not be supportive of any reintroduction of the right to buy. And just as I mentioned earlier, and as Elaine said, a big focus of our programme is actually buying for, you know, council houses that were purchased and bringing them up to standard. And we also now have extended that where we're trying to target particular blocks to bring them up to standard, where we will, if it's the last... if it's only one owner in the block, we will allow the owner to stay as a tenant, because the big majority of the inquiries we get are from people who want to sell their house back to us, but they remain as a tenant. So maybe people that have bought us and the right to buy can't afford to maintain it. So we are looking at that now in limited circumstances as well. So it's the opposite, I think.
Thank you. Thanks, Gavino.
Colin wanted to come in.
I was just going to come back to your point on net zero, and some really good points have been made here and in the previous session, and we're seeing some really innovative work right across the country on net zero and being able to progress that. And as Pam says, and as Elaine says, you know, moving on with that fabric first approach and getting the fabric of the building, but the heat source is a really important bit, and so again. Looking at those different ways of looking at that in terms of air source, and it's really interesting. We hear an Applecross looking at a heat network solution, but being able to look at these things with a different lens and maybe taking a place-based approach to this, because it allows you then to think about what you're building new and also the existing stock, and to look at heat in a much more strategic way. And I think even widening the lens beyond that, I think it brings in the point around supply chain. So we've got a big opportunity here with a large investment programme in new build and in terms of upgrading existing properties to look at how we can look at local supply chains for heat pumps and all sorts of things. So that's the exciting opportunity that's ahead, and just building the blocks for that.
Thank you.
Thanks for that. And I'm just going to stay with the Future Housing Trust. And again, you're not sure who to direct this to, so you can decide among yourselves. So we're curious to know how your work is enabling the development of strategic housing sites and any lessons that can be learned.
I guess there are different aspects to that. So some of it is about funding, financing innovation. Some of it is about collaboration. Some of it is about place. So maybe a good example of a place-based approach is our Drossen, so old school site, and effectively how that site connects as housing to the wider town, another investment that's going on. So it's effectively, it's all planned together so that you have access to services. There's the reuse of land, the reuse of surplus estate, maybe within the public sector. So taking that place-based approach around Drossen is another one. Granton, I mentioned earlier on, which is probably now more about funding, started as place-based and understanding the role of Granton in the city and elements around the learning journey and the partners who stood around that. But it's now coming right down to funding. And that point I made earlier on, that how do you corral all the different funding sources to sit around that project to deliver something at scale? And then maybe using Winchborough as an example, again, around that funding type of innovation. So effectively a challenge with unlocking some of that upfront infrastructure and effectively helping the local authority manage the bumps and peaks and troughs in Section 75 so that there's effectively a standby facility that's come through government that can be drawn upon if the profile of build doesn't follow that as planned. So there's various ways that support can sort of manifest itself, if you like.
Thanks very much for your response on that. It's very helpful with those examples. I've made notes to go and learn more about those places. And it also makes me think we had a visit to Govan recently, and I think there's something going on similar there. I'm now going to bring Paul in with some questions.
I'm going to ask the same question I asked at the first panel around about private investment. How can new forms of private investment be levered into provision of affordable homes? Are there new models that can be used more widely? I want to try and expand that a little bit more than talking about the build-to-rent sector, which is growing in Scotland, and also talking about the role of equity share as well. So maybe if you can wrap the answers into that. Tom, I know you touched on that in your opening statement. I don't know if you want to just talk around a little bit more around about bringing in a private investment and then open it up to the panel, whoever wants to come in.
Yeah, of course. I mean, I think the experience we've had is that there's real appetite out there, if the vehicles are right, for investment into property housing in Scotland. And our MMR fund is a good example of that, because it's still, you know, I talked about the rents earlier, so, you know, it's effectively still, you know, low rents, and people are interested in investing in. So our development programme through Places for People Capital was initially around 1,000 properties with scale to grow, 182 million invested in. And it's something that we're continuing to focus on and continue to do. So I think it's an example of a success story. And it was learnings that our group had in England that we, you know, developed the work in Scotland. And the investment generally is coming from pension funds as a general rule. So I think that it's an area of absolute growth, and it's something that that we're keen to do. Of course, you know, with some of the challenges that we're all seeing, it's so important that those numbers continue to work. But it's something that our organisation is committed to. I think on the purely affordable social rent side of it, I think it's harder for obvious reasons when you've got the return. So how we can find a way to do more in that area of bringing in additional capital is another question. I think that you'll also see that there is, if you look down south in what's been happening there, there are examples of for-profit providers coming into the space of affordable housing. We're a non-profit, of course, but I think that there is more moves into this area by people who are there to create profit, which shows that there's opportunity there, I think is my point.
I'll open up. Just on that, is there enough coordination, in your opinion, at the moment across the sector? And I'm talking about housing providers, not just across, obviously, the pension providers. You know, so is there a need for more coordination across the sector around about opportunities around about private investment, from your opinion? And is there enough coordination from the pension providers to try and look at the, you know, what are the barriers? How can we open it up? Where are the opportunities? Sort of thing.
I think that my view is that the larger organisations are the ones that have the ability more often to bring in, you know, big amounts of capital, just purely because of scale. From that point of view, our approach is to use our vehicle, but that is in collaboration with Scottish Government and others. So I think there's more to be done in this space around collaboration and engagement, from my view. But it still feels quite early. in the journey on this. So, there's more to be done.
I don't know if you want to say anything on the build to rent or equity share, and I'll open it up to anybody else who wants to come in on that. Chair, who wants to come in?
Neil.
Yeah, I mean, just around again, like Tom, we have experience of some of that institutional investment coming in. So I mentioned Lahr Housing Trust earlier on. There's finance that's come from institutions in alongside other tools that the public sector had. We're also looking at models. We have the Housing Delivery Partnership model, which is mid-market provision through local authorities. East Lothian have used an institutional investment there and are looking at more. So I guess for us as the public sector, there is the potential around some of these approaches. Where we are at the moment is, again, through that collaboration, thinking about what do we want to get out of those models and how do they then fit. So at the moment, it can be quite piecemeal. People will come to you with deals and suggestions, and that's okay because it helps grow knowledge. But actually, what do we want more holistically from that sector, I think, is a big part of it. So we are looking at that along with some others around this end of the table at the moment.
Neil, thanks for that. I was a councillor in East Lothian up until last week for 15 years, and obviously we're in the scheme, and obviously the constituency MSP as well. So, yeah, well aware of it. Hence part of the reason, because you see the opportunities around about that, and I've met Lahr as well. And so that's interesting to know. Yeah. I don't know if anybody else wants to come in that point. Stephen?
I'll maybe come in, and I'll draw a big distinction between social rented housing, which must be owned and let by a local authority or a housing association, and other forms of intermediate tenure, mid-market, shared equity, etc. So for the social rented housing, there's a good history of institutional investment in Scottish housing associations in particular. Our first public listed bond in the stock exchange was 2014. Lots of insurance companies, pension funds, etc. there, and been followed by lots of other housing associations doing private debt placements, for example. It's always a battle, I would say, to keep the awareness of Scotland up on the investor radar and agenda, because it tends to be a UK-wide debate around social housing, and you can get caught up in these issues that predominantly relate to England, such as right to buy and cladding and so on. And we have a different position on these issues in Scotland. So there's been a lot of good work done by people like SFT, and a shout out as well to Scottish Housing Regulator, who've been very good at making the awareness amongst the investor community of the differences in Scotland come through. We've had lots of individual discussions about ad hoc deals on build to rent and mid-market rent and coming in, and we've got some of those ongoing, which are good, positive, tend to be focused on areas where the local housing allowance supports it, though, because for mid-market in particular, the starting rent is the local housing allowance, which it caps it. So in Edinburgh, you can do something. In Aberdeen, you can do something. In North Lanarkshire, it's very difficult. In Renfrewshire and Inverclyde, it's very difficult. And that goes to the structural nature of the way the local housing allowance levels are set.
Stephen, because the question I was going to then follow up was, what can the Scottish Government do, and what can the Scottish Parliament do in that regard to try and mitigate the barriers that you just mentioned in there?
Yeah, I think, the things that I've been to events here in the evening where investor community and so on are invited, and more of that sort of thing, is very positive, because I think we have a good story to tell, actually, in Scottish social and affordable housing around the positive differences that we have. We don't have the right to buy. We have a very good and supportive grant regime, actually, that's the envy of our colleagues in England. And the more we can do to tell that story and sell the positives of that amongst investors, I think the better. We get our credit rating by Standard & Poor's. We're due to get our result in the next couple of days. And you'll see in that report lots of these things played through, but I'm not always sure the awareness is there down south of that.
Thanks. No one's anybody else.
No, I don't think so. Great. Okay, so now going to move on to questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Kavina. Similar to the question asked the last panel, just wanted to ask if witnesses had any comments about how their investment decisions, how their new build programmes are impacting on rent levels, whether the new build programmes are essentially predicated on rent rises, and whether that's causing any concerns about the affordability of rents. I wonder whether I could put that to Elaine, Pam and Stephen.
Elaine, yep.
In terms of rent increases, obviously what we do is plan over a 30-year period in terms of our HRA business plan. And we had assumed rent increases moving forward. But in light of the cost of living crisis that we've experienced, our decision was made to freeze our council rents both this financial year and last financial year in response to that. But the ambition remains to deliver our affordable housing commitment and to deliver the investment in terms of existing homes. So moving forward from there, we need to then look at how we can do that, how we can find ways to bring in the grant funding and other types of funding that could support that so that all of that pressure does not fall on rents moving forward. It is absolutely the case that we can't deliver new build at the expense of investment in existing stock or the other way around. So we need, I think in the Edinburgh context at least, we need to find a way forward to be able to deliver both those commitments for the city. And I think for us that's really about, working with both More Homes Division, Better Homes Division, looking strategically across the support there is for investment in housing across the board, whether that be new homes or existing homes.
Thanks. Anybody else want to comment on that, Pam?
Yeah. So we have increased the rents in the last few years to support the investment programmes, both in terms of the existing stock. We're also reprovisioning our multi-storey flats, so there's a large-scale demolition programme in terms of the flats, and obviously to replace those flats with new homes. So the rent increase has supported that investment. But as Elaine said, I mean we've also got the 30-year business plan. We've made various assumptions around costs. And we're having to constantly, review and update that and assess what, we can afford in terms of the going forward and recognising all the other cost pressures that tenants are facing at the moment. So it's certainly a balancing act. We also had made a decision when we started the new build programme that we put a 20% premium on the new build rents. But again, our rents are still below the Scottish average, but when you add the 20% rent premium, they're now just under £100 on average. So we are having to start looking at, particularly when we go forward in terms of some of the change in the heating types that maybe means that it won't be as... tenants might have to spend more than maybe they did currently. So we are having to look at the options there and whether the rent premium is something that we... really would want to continue with and the impact of that on the overall programme.
Thanks for that. Mark, do you have another question?
I don't know if Stephen has any response to that from the...
Yep, sorry, Stephen wanted to come in. Yes, sorry about that, yes.
I think I was the third on his list, yes. We wouldn't increase rent specifically for the purpose of subsidising new build. That's quite an important principle for us. So grant has to be the balancing figure, because if it's not, what you're doing is taking money from existing tenants and investment in their homes and using that to plug a gap in new build scheme. And we don't think that's right, particularly given the context of cost of living crisis and pressures on our cost base as well. As an organisation, we have these things like utilities and inflation across our cost base. You know, we welcomed the change to the benchmark grant rates last November. We thought that was a positive step, and we've just about been able to make things keep working with those, although we're now bumping up already against some challenges with those, as been reflected earlier. We also welcomed the fact in the revised subsidy regime that there'll be an annual review, we understand, of those benchmark grant rates. And we think that's really important 1 year on from that resetting last November that happens. And we would hope it will respond to the inflationary pressures, but no, in our business plan, we wouldn't see ourselves increasing rents to plug that gap. That's an important principle.
Thanks very much. Mark, any more questions?
Okay. No, thanks, Kevin. No?
Okay. I'm just going to ask the question about, I don't know if it got covered, but I wanted to ask if it's my kind of new favourite thing, this modern methods of construction, if anybody is working with that. Colin, and then Frank.
I'll allow Frank to come in and say what's happening on the ground, and I can maybe talk about what's happening.
Great, yeah, Frank.
So yes, we are using and exploring the different methods, modern methods of construction, as the term has now been coined. So we used things like closed panel timber frame, but these the methods tend to be similar, and we're all kind of fishing in the same marketplace for that. So it's generally speaking, in terms of the regulations and especially with the fabric first approach, there is a drive down towards timber frame, and I think it's important that we look at other modern methods of construction, especially modular, because that will take a pressure off of the sector through trades. For example, lots of the you know, modular, for example, is a good example where if it's factory built, it's not tradesmen you're using then, it's actually skilled technicians that you're using to put that together. So all of the aspects of construction are valid and good, but to spread that across means that you can take pressure off the market. Hopefully it takes a degree of the overheating out of the market that we're in at this moment in time, because there is a pressure right across from, as we talked about, land supply, but also through material supply right across the board in terms of all of industry. I mean, if anybody trying to buy a new car recently, they'll know that. But that translates, for example, semiconductors translates into air source heat pumps, which is difficult then, which puts pressure on programmes, which increases costs. So we've been using and looking at modern methods of construction. We'll continue to do so. But I think it's important, maybe support through government, and we've been accessing the Innovation Centre in Glasgow as well for advice on the types of construction that can be used. The important part in terms of modern methods of construction is scale. So it really is about scale. If individual projects are bespoke, then you lose the you lose some of the benefits of that anyway, in terms of the efficiencies that can be driven through a production line, for example. So it's really important, I think, and there's an opportunity, I think, given where we are in the market at this moment in time, to take that leap into developing that scale within the modern methods of construction that are out there.
Thanks very much for that. It seemed like a very enthusiastic response. And Colin, you want to come in?
It's a really good, enthusiastic response. And I think also it's representative of what we've been hearing this morning and what we've also heard around from different stakeholders around the country, and the work that we've been supporting the Scottish Government over the last 12 months or so. And I think it's important to understand that modern methods of construction, or really what we're calling a sort of moving towards manufacturing off-site construction, it's not new. And so Scotland is well ahead of the rest of the UK in delivering houses through off-site construction. So something like 80% of the homes built are through some form of timber frame. So it's a really good starting point. And also, so even from some of the examples that we're hearing this morning, there's a lot of momentum, a lot of interest. RSLs and local authorities willing to actually push the edges. We're seeing some really innovative stuff happening in rural areas around modular construction. So the opportunity, as Frank is saying, is to say, right, how can we take this to another level? And what has come through from the work that we've been doing is that it's quite clear that it will require some element of structural change. That's a sort of grand word, but it means that something new must happen at a local level or at project level. New things should happen at a national level, and there is also a requirement for something in between, some form of delivery mechanism to be able to move this forward across an appropriate geography. And that's what we're trialling on the southeast of Scotland, with Edinburgh showing great leadership in this, and working across all of the local authorities there, several housing associations, to say, right, is there a new business model to be able to move that along? And so that's what's being trialled. We've heard about different approaches to procurement, entering into longer-term partnerships. What's really important, as Frank is saying there, is around And it was mentioned earlier, we do need to look at common approaches across the housing providers. So there will be a need to be looking at an element of common typologies of house types and that sort of thing. And that is required by industry, but also, and a really key point is that it needs to be what we say demand-led. So we need to be able to structure the pipeline of work going forward. Industry needs a much more certain pipeline of work to be able to look for investment. So if we have, as we do, 110,000 houses to build, we need a bit more granularity in that, certainly in the short to medium term, to be able to map that out so we can, and then look at different business models to be able to do that. So what we see is there is a new procurement model emerging to be able to interface with industry in a very different way. Industry are very keen on that. Our work with the Construction Leadership Forum is saying we need to enter into new relationships with industry. There is a new business model across partners. We're terming it sort of horizontal collaboration across housing providers. So there's a new way of doing that in terms of aggregating demand, shaping the products that we want to deliver, and providing some sort of certainty. And then I say what I call it, there's a new economic model, something that needs to be led at a national level. So it brings in the supply chain opportunities and trying to look for consistency across the whole of the market. So to be able to step this up to the scale that's required and deliver the momentum that's required, there needs to be a look at how we make those changes. The work that's coming through with Edinburgh is really exciting. It's building a foundation for that, but we also need to scale it up to a national level. The Scottish Government have committed to this in 2040 and believe it's the right thing to do to be able to deliver the programme and move it forward and to do it in an efficient way. And it's not a white knight, it won't solve everything. But to meet some of the challenges we're talking about, to get into a programme approach and dealing with some of the issues we have around supply chains and competitiveness, it's really important to move ahead with that at pace.
Thanks very much, Colin. I think that's great to hear the articulation of the new procurement model, business model, and a new economic model going forward. And I think also, but what we've heard both on this panel and on the previous panel is the land issue, which underpins everything. We need to be tackling that. So I have to leave it there for now, but I think it's been a really, again, another very useful conversation around affordable housing. And it's something that the committee is keen to keep pursuing and hearing about. So thanks so much for joining us this morning and sharing your perspectives. And I now suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses.
The next item on our agenda for today is to take evidence on the Building Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022 from Patrick Harvey, Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights, David Blair, who's the Programme Director on Cladding Remediation, Stephen Scott, who's the Head of the Technical Unit of Building Standards, and Dr. Stephen Garvin, who is the Head of Building Standards at the Scottish Government. I welcome the Minister and his supporting officials to the meeting. We had an interesting discussion of the regulations with stakeholders at last week's meeting, which also touched on a number of issues relating to fire safety in buildings more generally, along with some challenges in respect to access of insurance. And members will also be aware that the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government made a ministerial statement on Thursday providing an update on the Single Building Assessment Programme. Before I open up to questions from the committee, I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to have the chance to address the committee today to update you on the progress of the Scottish Government's work on fire safety and energy regulations. I'll touch on fire safety first and then come to energy. A fire safety review panel was convened in late 2020 to examine how to ban the highest risk cladding materials from taller buildings and the role of BS 8414. Last week, the committee heard from Peter Drummond of the RIAS, who was the chair of the review panel, and I'm very grateful for the valuable contribution that was made by all members of the review panel. That review process is rigorous and lengthy, and the panel needs to consider a range of issues thoroughly before we undertake a public consultation. The outcome of the review was that regulations have been made to ban the highest risk metal composite materials from any further use as cladding or internal linings in all buildings. And they also ban combustible cladding from residential and other high-risk buildings over 11 metres in height. We've also brought forward regulation to ensure that all replacement cladding should meet the new standards. These changes are the latest in a series of changes that have been introduced since the tragedy at Grenfell Tower, including introducing sprinklers in all new flats, social housing and certain shared multi-occupancy residential buildings last year. And we had previous set requirements for two staircases as well as effective floor signage and fire service activated evacuation sounders in buildings over 18 metres. Of course, we're also taking action, as the convener mentioned, on unsafe cladding on existing buildings. And the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government made a statement to Parliament last week. I don't intend to cover that in my opening remarks. Obviously, if the committee wants to ask questions, I'll try to deal with some aspects, but others may be for the Cabinet Secretary to deal with. The energy improvements that we're introducing in October deliver another step toward improved energy and emission performance in our buildings and new homes in particular, with a strong focus on a fabric-first approach and on practical ways to reduce energy demand. We'll be going further on this with more significant changes in 2024, requiring new buildings to use zero-emission heating systems. These current changes support that intent, future-proofing installed heating systems in advance of those further regulations. I'm also keen that we continue to understand how we can achieve outcomes equivalent to recognise very low energy standards such as Passive House. Again, I'd like to recognise the contribution of the review panel on energy standards, which was chaired by Stephen Good, of the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre. We had over 170 responses to the energy consultation, and while there were some concerns expressed over the pace of change, there was no doubt of the overwhelming agreement that change is needed. I am happy to take questions from the committee at that point, Convener.
Thanks very much for your opening statement, and I now open up the session to questions from members, and I would like to begin by asking a few questions myself. Can the Minister assure the committee that fire safety will be a key consideration in any Scottish Government programme to retrofit existing homes with insulation? And further, what practical steps
are the Scottish Government taking to ensure that new fire hazards are not being introduced into existing homes?
Well, clearly the current standards are the result of a specific review into the type of cladding materials that have been giving most significant concern since Grenfell. And so the specific changes in this set of regulations will address those issues. Very clearly, the wider transformation of the energy performance of our homes needs to be done in a way that is safe, not just in terms of fire risk, but also contributes to healthy air quality within buildings, as well as addressing the direct energy issues. I don't know if Stephen, from the energy and the fire perspective, want to add anything.
Thanks. Yeah, so we've made changes to the requirements so that any replacement cladding needs to meet the current standards as from the 1st of June. And that would include, obviously, buildings over 11 metres requirement for the non-combustible materials to be used in the cladding system. So I think in terms of the safety of the cladding system itself, and that would include any, I could perhaps describe it as overcladding system, which would need to go through a building warrant process. But if existing cladding has been replaced, then perhaps a more efficient system, then it's got to meet the current standards. But I think that's probably the key thing from the current changes that would affect the existing buildings and their safety.
Thanks very much for that confirmation. Another question, what are the practical implications of new building regulation 3.28 requiring buildings to be designed to reduce the risks to occupants' health from overheating for developers? And what impact might it have on a homeowner's use of their property?
Thanks. The standard does introduce a requirement to mitigate the risk of summer overheating in new homes and new residential buildings that are used in a similar way. We're aware, of course, that this is a lower risk in Scotland than it is in other parts of the UK. But it's important that we establish that overheating can be a risk considered in our new build and examine how to mitigate the likely impacts of our future climate. The initial provisions take a fairly simple approach, focusing on the issues of heat gain through windows and removal of heat build-up through effective ventilation. There's also an option to model the risk for more unusual or highly glazed building types. And designers will address this by limiting excessive heat gain through the location and specification of windows and by improving the ventilation of buildings. These measures will provide occupiers with more assurance that their homes are warm and easy to heat, but also comfortable in the summer months.
Thank you. And then a question about direct emissions heating. So what practical impact might the requirement to design and construct buildings with direct emissions heating systems to be capable of reducing the energy demands of the buildings have on the design and use of new homes?
Well, the 2024 new build heat standard, when we bring that forward, our proposal is that direct emissions heating systems will no longer be permitted in new buildings. And a further consultation this summer will set out details of plans to remove gas, oil and biofuel boilers as options from 2024. The 22 regulations still permit the construction of new homes with these heating systems, but they do set more challenging overall emissions and energy performance targets. The 22 standards will ask for any building with a direct emissions heating system to be designed for simple future retrofit, an installation of a zero direct emissions source, and information on that option to be provided to the owner as well. And from this year, wet heating systems in all new buildings should be designed to operate at lower temperatures to optimise the efficient operation of zero direct emission systems such as heat pumps in the future.
Thanks very much for your responses. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin with a few questions.
Thanks, Camina. The regulations that have been laid are set the height at 11 metres, where non-combustible cladding materials will have to be used. And I think I welcome that. That seems like a very robust approach to take. Like I say, I do welcome, but I just wonder what the rationale was for that 11 metre height to be chosen and whether that decision will be kept under review.
The building regs that we're proposing are broadly in line with the proposition that was consulted on, and the response to that consultation was supportive of the general approach that we're taking. I'm not sure if Dr. Garvin wants to add something about the origin of why 11 was considered as part of the development of the proposal that we bring forward.
Okay. So 11 metres came in from October 2019 in the work of the review panel in over the period 2018-19. And the rationale behind it was to align with firefighting from the ground. So put simply, fire service could get a jet of water onto the side of a building up to a height of 11 metres comfortably in the vast majority of situations. So that is the rationale behind that. That is a trigger height. What we've done now is to make a further change to the regulation itself to require non-combustible materials above 11 metres, which is obviously going to come in on the 1st of June as a requirement, but the 11 metre rationale is about firefighting from the ground. There is further consideration. UK government and counterparts in Wales and Northern Ireland set around about 18 metres before the regulations kick in. I know that we're all looking at the trigger heights and what's the right thing to do, and exchanging information on that. So if we do have further evidence or research coming forward around about the right sort of trigger height, then of course we will come back to this in the future as well. And we monitor with Local Authority Building Standards Scotland and others the introduction of the new standard and you know, how effective that is being in practice, etc.
And it's worth reinforcing the point that the 11 metre height doesn't apply to the most highly combustible cladding materials, which are banned from all new build, rather than the types that are permitted up to 11 metres.
Thanks. Mark, do you have more questions?
Yeah, thanks for that. I just wondered as well whether you could outline why the ban on using highly combustible metal composite material is limited to material with a thickness of up to 10 millimetres or with the gross calorific value of 35 megajoules per kilogram of more, whether you'll set out again why those values were chosen.
Again, on a highly technical matter, I'm going to rely on officials on this occasion.
Okay, thanks much. That I'll try and answer this. I think that the Fire Safety Review Panel considered this matter in some detail. The intention was to address the sort of metal composite materials that were used at Grenfell Tower and clearly have been used on other buildings as well. And we've seen the evidence from that event and also from subsequent testing that's been carried out of the extent of fire spread that can happen. So we looked into to the market for that type of material, and we think that the overall thickness is generally thinner than 10 millimetres, so it covers the kind of range of products that we have. I think the important thing to note here is obviously if manufacturers begin to try to game that system, then we will bring forward further change. What we didn't want to do with this was to capture a wider set of products which are used in the right location and the right purpose are perfectly acceptable materials. It was to, I suppose, just to close off if people are still using this material or if we get into a future situation where perhaps some of the corporate memory begins to fade around it, that we don't, you know, we regulate to keep it out of the market. But we will, if there is evidence that things aren't being done properly, then we will bring that back to ministers for further consideration.
And a similar approach is being taken to the definition of the materials we're talking about between Scottish Government, UK, Welsh and Northern Ireland. So there does seem to be a degree of consensus that's emerged throughout this period of each administration taking forward reviews since Grenfell, and there does seem to be a general agreement on the definition being used.
That's helpful to know and reassuring as well, since we heard from witnesses last week about concerns that manufacturers may try to game the system. So it's helpful to know that that will be kept under review. But finally, Convener, if I could just ask a question about BS 8414. We've heard concerns about the application and the use of that as a route to compliance for cladding on building. I know that that has changed now, that any application to use BS 8414 must be notified to the Building Standards Division in Government, but I just wonder if that is robust enough, given the concerns around that, and whether the Minister has concerns about BS 8414 being used as a route to compliance going forward.
I think following the work of the review panel, we are satisfied that the approach that we're taking will give adequate safety. The European Commission, I think, if I recall rightly, is working with colleagues to look at alternative approaches to large-scale testing, and so it's an area where there will, I suspect, continue to be developing practice about how fire safety tests can be used. But I think until that work bears fruit, the approach that we're taking on implementing a ban is the one which will give confidence to building occupiers and to the construction sector that we're taking an approach that guarantees safety.
I think I would just add to that the obviously the regulations now would prevent the use 8414 above 11 metres for housing blocks and other relevant buildings. An applicant could come forward with an 8414 test to support building warrant application below 11 metres. However, even that would be notified to ourselves. One thing to perhaps note as well is that through Building Standards Futures Board, we're developing a compliance plan approach for higher risk buildings, and that would include the role of a compliance plan manager who is actively monitoring compliance and gathering the information both during the design construction process. And so we're looking to improve that process, reduce the opportunity for non-compliance, so that in this case the system that's actually been tested and is intended for use in the building is actually the one that ends up there.
Thanks very much. Mark, is that...
Yeah, thanks, Kavina.
Okay, great. We're now going to move into wider issues, and I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Or sorry, good afternoon, Minister. From the evidence we took last week from a range of experts, there was a strong support, obviously, for the Scottish Government's single building assessment. Can you provide an update on the single building assessment pilot, please?
Yes, well, obviously some of these issues were dealt with by the Cabinet Secretary in the statement last week. The single building assessment is intended to overcome a difference in the UK tenure systems, where Scotland doesn't have a single building owner. And the committee will be aware that the single building assessment is about the safety of buildings and the people in them, and it includes a generic fire risk assessment as well as the external wall appraisal. It needs to be carried out in a professional and rigorous manner, and it's only by undertaking this work that we can identify where changes to existing systems may need to be made. There is a fairly high degree of confidence that the majority of buildings will be found to be safe, so the merely conducting an assessment shouldn't give people severe cause for anxiety. But it's the work that needs to be undertaken in order to identify where those changes have to happen. Training of surveyors to undertake the external wall appraisals is underway, and we expect that will improve the capacity of the sector to deliver the assessments that are necessary. The level of competence of those undertaking the work is really not an option. So we have to work with the sector to increase the supply of competent professionals who can undertake this work. And I think that the committee will probably understand the need to work with the sector to increase capacity, but also to make sure that those assessments are conducted to the standard that's required. And I think it's an important principle as well that the government has ensured that those are come at zero cost to homeowners as well.
Thanks for that.
Thanks. I'm now going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. Oh, good afternoon. We're all behind. It's been a long meeting. Can I ask to start off with, how many buildings in Scotland have had combustible cladding now removed or remediated since the Grenfell tragedy of 2017?
Well, the committee, as I said in the last answer, will be aware that the single building assessment process is the work that needs to be undertaken to identify where we believe changes need to be made. I don't know if David wants to come in with any further assessment about numbers that have been
I would just build off the fact of what the Minister said. We don't collect data on the entire country's stock for that purpose. What we do is we focus on the most high-risk buildings. So we have the high-rise inventory, which is a published data set, which identifies buildings of all tenure above 18 metres, and we continue to work to refine that. In terms of the number of buildings assessed, we are kicking off with our pilot programme. So we have 26 under active consideration just now. And as the Cabinet Secretary said last week, we're looking to expand that rapidly. So in the course of the next few weeks and months, we'll be writing to the balance of the expression of interest group that applied last year. So that'll take the number of buildings in the pilot, the most high-risk buildings, if you like, from 26 to over 100. And then from April next year, we'll be expanding that by approximately another 100 or so. So it's a methodical approach to trying to find and work with and assess the most high-risk buildings. But we don't collect data on the whole housing stock. And that's part of the work that we've got underway, is to try and improve the quality of the data set on particularly the mid-rise buildings, which is where there's more unknowns.
Thank you. And of those 26 buildings which have been identified in the single building assessment pilot, how many have received payments then to enable these assessments to then take place?
Sure, I'll So in terms of the status of the SBA, so I think just to be consistent with what the Cabinet Secretary said last week, we have 26 in the pilot, we have about 16 in the review phase, and we have about 10 in a state of active survey work or completion. So I think the number of payments we've made, I don't have the data exactly, but it's about single digits. So we published our spend data last week, so we can refer you to that offline if that's helpful.
Thank you. The budget of £97 million, which UK government's passed on to ministers, why have we seen more progress made by the Department for Levelling Up Housing and Communities to get that money out there then, compared to what's happened in Scotland?
Well, I mean, I think throughout this, there has been, as I'm afraid there quite often is, a difficulty in getting clarity from the UK government in a timely way, either about the consequentials that are available or indeed about other aspects of how we might have been able to work together more closely in a more collaborative way to address this entire issue. I think Miles Briggs will recall the frustration that the Cabinet Secretary expressed, I think, during the statement about the inability of not just the Scottish Government but the Welsh Government as well to successfully make the case for the UK to work constructively with us around the same table to produce a shared and a coherent response to this. Some of the approaches that the UK government is taking for England only also make use of the availability of UK level reserve powers. And so there's a great deal about this entire situation, which I would say could have been a very strong case for collaborative working between the governments within the UK, and it's not for the want of trying. In terms of the work that needs to happen now, we clearly have to continue with the single building assessment in order to identify where specific changes need to be made, and with not only homeowners and building owners, but the developer community as well, to ensure that work can be funded. Is there something to add?
If that's all right. I think just one thing that's worth just bearing in mind is I think the English tenure system is obviously structurally fundamentally different, and there is a particular inbuilt advantage to having a legal owner of the skin of a building, which has made designing a programme of intervention based on a funding model a degree easier than in Scotland, where we obviously have to transact with homeowners collectively, and obviously in the existence of factors that accelerates the process of developing things a bit, but up to a point, and that is not a comprehensive solution, obviously, for many, many blocks in Scotland where there is no factor. So I think it's one of the reasons why it has been somewhat easier, but not easy, to start work in England.
Thanks for that. And I heard what the Cabinet Secretary had to say, and the Minister's repeated that today, but a lot of progress has been made in Wales, which we haven't seen work really begin on, specifically, I think, around what the Welsh Government are now proposing around buying out owners as well. So there does seem to be slower progress in Scotland compared to Wales with the same devolved powers available. Finally, I wanted to ask specifically with regards to underwriting professional indemnity insurance for surveyors and fire safety assessors. Is that something the Scottish Government would consider taking forward as well?
I'll again answer the comment.
I think it's fair to say that there's nothing off the table at this point. One of the lessons that we've learned from working very closely as far as possible with our colleagues across the UK is that there is no one size fits all, and there is no perfect solution to any of these issues. There are many issues overlapping. PI, you know, obviously from the UK government's perspective, their primary intervention is in the form of a state-backed PI scheme, which we understand to continue to face some delays and difficulty. But it is nevertheless welcomed by the sector, and we will consider it, you know, in light of what is eventually delivered. From our perspective, we must use the tools that we have as an organisation, as a body, as a devolved administration. So there's nothing off the table. We do have a number of options which all bear different risk profiles. So that includes, for example, hiring our own fire engineers or self-insuring providers, or as I say, we will evaluate all of these, you know, very, very rapidly as we have moved to a new delivery model for the SBA, which is more about direct commissioning. And it brings those kind of those choices to bear a bit more clearly for us. So we'll be thinking that through over the next few months.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. And I'm now going to bring in Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning. Good afternoon, Minister. I've been falling for the same trap. And good afternoon, panel. One of the things we heard last week in the from the panel last week was talking about people who were trapped in zero-valued homes and issues particularly about accessing affordable buildings insurance. I'm just wondering, is there practical help that the Scottish Government could offer in that regard?
Well, very clearly, the impact that the presence of potentially unsafe, and I would stress potentially unsafe, because we, as I said earlier, we are confident that the assessments will find that the majority of buildings are safe, but the presence of potentially unsafe cladding has had a significant impact on people, and I've met people within my own region who are in that situation, and I'm sure other members will have had that experience as well. And we've within government had regular correspondence from people who are unable to move. I would, however, come back to the point that that is fundamentally the reason why we need to conduct the single building assessments. The reason for this approach and the progress on that was reported in the Cabinet Secretary's statement. We're taking action to roll that approach out faster to more buildings. We fully expect that most buildings will be found to be safe, but where there is a risk found, then it should be remediated. And the government has always been clear that developers fundamentally have to play their part and step up to remedy buildings with unsafe cladding. Even some of the people that I've spoken to who are in this extremely difficult situation are not making the case, not to me anyway, that the taxpayer should effectively bail out a cost that they believe that the developers ought to bear. There's a general acceptance that the developer community needs to play its part in ensuring that that work takes place.
I can understand the point that's made. I suppose if we've then got developers who don't comply, what's the next steps beyond that kind of thing? Because I think you've probably seen, as we know, probably more developers who've been more compliant and probably quicker to move on things than others. I'm just wondering, in between that time until developers do that, is there anything that the Scottish Government can do in terms of legislation or any other matters to try and push that forward?
Well, some of the relevant powers here are reserved to the UK government, particularly around insurance. The regulation of insurance is not something that we're able to intervene in with devolved powers. And obviously, insurance premiums are a matter for individual insurers. We are working with the Association of British Insurers through the cladding stakeholder group, and through that forum, we're very much seeking fair treatment for homeowners by the insurance industry. The answer to all of the issues is through working together to reach solutions that are going to work for people, and that is going to include insurers and lenders as well. What we believe would help people most is that where developers or others step up to carry out remediation work, then the insurers should trust the single building assessment process to deliver a safe building and return the market to acceptable premium levels. And I was pleased to hear last week at the committee that the ABI and many of their member companies welcome the single building assessment approach and what it could deliver.
Just a follow-up question, if that's okay. One of the things we heard of last week as well was calls for the single building assessment form to form the basis of a building MOT system and the creation of a central repository on information on buildings as they're constructed. Is that something the Scottish Government would support or has views on at the moment?
Again, I'll ask Stephen Garvin whether that's something that's been explored in precisely those terms.
So, I think the idea in MOT has been considered. What we're looking at is to create a register of safe buildings. So I suppose harnessing the the data that's gathered in the single building assessments and sort of presenting that in a format which is usable by the building owners, factors, insurers, lenders, etc. as well. So that's certainly a development we want to see, and we'll develop further from the current high-rise inventory.
Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. Willie, you wanted to come in on a supplementary on the zero-valued homes?
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Patrick, it was a supplementary on Paul's question. It's about the zero valuation that we discussed last week, and we think it was based on the EWS1 standard, which we then discovered doesn't have any legal basis in Scotland. We think it's not a statutory process. So we were left wondering how people in Scotland can have a zero value attached to their property from a scheme that isn't a regulatory standard in Scotland and potentially legally doesn't apply. Is there any clarification you could offer the committee on that issue?
Thank you. Well, the cladding stakeholder group does meet regularly to discuss issues like this and to engage with the RICS, UK Finance and the Law Society and others to explore these issues. The responsibility for the buying and selling of property does need to take a proportionate approach and only require EWS1 for blocks that fall within the guidance from the RICS. The system was put in place by the lending industry, and while we understand why that approach was taken, we believe it must be applied proportionately. In Scotland, it's been applied flat by flat rather than in relation to whole blocks, and again, as a result of what David was describing earlier, the common ownership model that we have here. However, we're working with the stakeholders to try and ensure that they will accept a whole building EWS1 as an output from the single building assessment process.
Thank you. Thank you for that. What would happen in the circumstances where a homeowner disagrees with that zero value assessment of their property and chooses to challenge that? Because, as I've said, our understanding is that it doesn't form any legal basis in Scotland.
Can I ask David to jump in again?
I've had a number of conversations sort of along these lines with UK Finance, and I think they're always at pains to try and educate us on this. So I'll try and convey what my understanding is. The EWS1 form doesn't actually provide a valuation itself. It is our I don't mean this critically, but it's a simplistic way of answering a complicated question about the risk of a building for lending purposes. At least one, it's probably unfair to name them, but at least one lender takes a quite a nuanced view of it. So whatever the rating is, they have a process that may zero value if you get, for example, a B rating that suggests there is combustible cladding. But what that means is it's a trigger for the lender to refer it to their specialist team to then think about and gather more information about the suitability of that block. Because in Scotland, for example, it will be an EWS1 based on a flat rather than the whole block. So it requires them to be a bit more responsible and to think through, to gather evidence about the rest of the block. And then what can happen is they can then revisit their valuation. So I think in practical terms, no property that's classed as zero valuation is truly worth nothing. What it means is it's just very difficult to get a standard mortgage on standard terms. It just means it's much more difficult because the risk is perceived to be much higher. The problem is the level of risk is very difficult to price, and that's where you get compounded issues with the buildings insurance industry, who have had difficulty pricing the risk for blocks. Where that feeds into it, you get some really, really difficult dynamics. And that's where the single building assessment process, where it will consider including an EWS1 on the whole block, will give you a more solid answer, and then a plan can be agreed for the whole block. And that's where the start of the assurance journey for UK Finance and other stakeholders begins. From our perspective, that's the start of getting a green light for that block, whether it's green light to start with or green light after a process of remediation.
Yeah, but nevertheless, are people not in the position where at this moment their houses, their properties are valued at £0 until remediation can be carried out? Because we were hearing some examples of that last week, that people are being told that their properties are valued at £0.
I mean, the short answer is yes. But the as we've continued to say, the work that needs to happen in order to address the situation that people are in is the SBA process and the subsequent actions where the assessments determine it's necessary.
For that.
Yep. Thanks very much for that. So I've got three more questions. So the next one's about house builders and the Scottish Safer Building Accord. So what commitments have house builders made to fund remediation and mitigation works under the Scottish Safer Building Accord? And what happens if a developer chooses not to sign up to the accord?
Once again, I'm going to turn to officials for support on a rather detailed aspect of this.
It's a fast-moving agenda. We've met a number of the high-level... So our approach to the Scottish Safer Buildings Accord is to partly borrow from what the UK government has been able to achieve with large-scale developers, but it's to draw the net wider in terms of the types of developers and also the types of stakeholders. So we want homeowners and UK Finance and others to be part of that. And that is about responding to a very, very powerful message by all stakeholders that they would like a more collaborative approach to the solving this problem. In terms of progress made, we've met, I think it's around 7 or 8 of the leading developers. Those are the developers, we've prioritised meeting the developers who have signed the UK pledge. And the reason for that is to try and determine the appetite for extending their responsibilities in England to Scotland on a common basis. We felt that that was a reasonable expectation. And I think the Cabinet Secretary was quite clear about that in her statement. So the feedback so far, and I'll keep this at a general level, but the feedback so far has been more or less universally positive about the appetite to remediate buildings on a common basis. And to be clear, that is... I'll borrow from the wording of the UK pledge, that is to remediate buildings to current building standards back 30 years. So that is the standard that's been set already at an England level, and we are asking the same thing. So that's our progress so far. We are working with Homes for Scotland on the mechanism for engaging not just the Homes for Scotland members, which are the 60 biggest members, but also the much broader sector of smaller and medium-sized developers. And so we'll develop a process and bring that forward in the next few months as we go.
Thanks very much for that response. The next question is about staffing the single building assessment programme. So what is the Scottish Government doing to support the training of surveyors and fire safety assessors to ensure there is a sufficient pool of qualified staff to deliver the single building assessment programme within a reasonable timescale?
As I mentioned in my opening remarks, we are working with industry to ensure that capacity does grow to meet the demand for the assessments as they come through. I'm not sure if we've got any more recent updates on the work that's been undertaken to ensure that skills and capacity are grown to meet the demand?
I don't have anything more on the... Is it the RICS funding or training, Stephen?
Just to say, we meet with the RICS and institution, the fire engineers, on a regular basis around this. And we are, working with them so that the RICS has a course around the assessment of the appraisal of the external wall systems and buildings to train surveyors around that. That will help us with capacity. We know there are quite a number of people, we don't have up-to-date numbers, I'm afraid, but already progressing through that. What we're working with the RICS on is a little bit of a bolt-on to that training so that the single building assessment process is added to it so that they're aware of the expectation there, how to deal with building owners, deal with them, hopefully you know what I mean, the outputs that are required and the standard that's required for the single building assessment. So that's what we've got in progress. We can obviously... perhaps, Minister, come back to the committee with an update on that training and how it's progressing.
Thanks very much. And the final question is that the committee heard at the last session for greater day-to-day independent monitoring and assessment of building work through the use of Clerk of Works, something the committee's predecessor called for. What's the Scottish Government doing to require or facilitate the use of Clerks of Works?
Again, I'm going to turn to Stephen on this one.
Okay. So I think the... Perhaps to answer this, not so much from the point of view of Clerk of Works, but to reiterate through the building standards system, the work that we're doing through the Building Standards Futures Board, and that builds on the earlier review post-Edinburgh Schools, post-Grenfell, of compliance and enforcement. The review panel there was chaired by Professor John Cole, and one of the key recommendations was around a compliance plan that would begin for higher risk buildings at a pre-application stage. So, and what we've recently consulted on is bringing into that the role of a compliance plan manager, and that would be someone who would have a oversight view of compliance really right throughout the process. Now, we're still working through the detail of that, and what we want to do is looking to trial it through some of the cladding remediation programmes, and also we're working on a pilot with a local authority at the moment around a new build school campus project. So that's underway, and that will give us more robustness around the compliance plan. I think other than that, in terms of Clerk of Works, the generally in the, I suppose, the public side of things, social housing side, then Clerk of Works would be the norm in any case. But the compliance plan manager role would apply for any high-risk building, regardless if it's public or private ownership.
Great, thanks for that. Okay. Willie, you want to come in?
Aye, thanks very much, Arianne. It's on that point about who ultimately will certify that a house, a new build, is compliant with all of these standards. Will it be that compliance manager, or will it be the old Clerk of Works, or will it be the person that issues a building warrant? Who's going to look at the construction and the fabric and what's in the construction and the new build to say that it meets all the standards for fire safety and any other regulations that may apply to the construction process as well? Who will sign on the dotted line that it's compliant?
Well, yes, the compliance plan manager would have responsibility for all aspects of compliance, not only in relation to the fire safety issues that we've talked about here, but the wider compliance with building regulations. It might be worthwhile if we were to write to the committee with an update on the pilot that Stephen mentioned, to let committee members know how that's developing and when we expect to be able to evaluate it more fully.
Very welcome, thank you.
Miles, you wanted to come in?
Thank you. Just on that point, I wondered what assessment had been made by the government, very much prompted by Dame Judith Thackett's review in England. Now, I know that applied to England, but it was quite substantial, I think, pointing towards building regulations not being fit for purpose. So I just wondered where the Scottish Government had looked at that, whether or not we would likely see a review in Scotland, and whether or not that could form a building safety bill or something like that coming forward as well.
Well, I'm not aware of suggestion that we need an entire bill on this matter, but the changes that we're bringing forward, committee members will be aware, are only the latest in a series of changes that we've brought through since Grenfell, relating to the fire safety issues and further changes that we're planning on the energy side. So I think it's more a case of continuous development in relation to existing concerns and future challenges that the building stock is going to face, rather than necessarily a single sort of big bang approach. I don't know if Stephen wants to add anything on that.
I can add a little bit in that the I referred to the earlier review of compliance and enforcement, and the review panel there concluded that the system in Scotland wasn't broken in the same way that Dame Judith concluded for England, but it could be improved. And our approach to that was to create the Futures Board and the work streams within it, with a focus around compliance enforcement. But a number of aspects that all contribute to that, in particular a workforce strategy for building standards verifiers, and digital transformation and other things. So, yeah, that's...
But I think the same concerns which I outlined in England, though, point towards potentially Scottish building standards needing that wider review. Would you accept that, though, given that's what's likely to now happen in England with the Westminster Bill?
I mean, in terms of review, I think it's pretty clear that building standards are continuously under review and are continuously evolving. I mean, ever since I've been a member of the Scottish Parliament, there have been regular updates and continuous incremental improvements to building standards. I think as Stephen was indicating, there are differences in the context in Scotland and England. I think we need to ensure that we're hearing from the widest range of stakeholders in relation to the Scottish situation and continue to develop and improve based on what the challenges and the requirements are here, rather than thinking that we need to echo actions that are being taken in England for an English context.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Camilla.
Okay, thank you very much. And so I thank the Minister and officials for this very helpful discussion. And as we agreed at the start of the meeting, we'll take the next item in private, and I now close the public part of the meeting. Thank you.